Good evening. Welcome to the Diamonds Forever 3113 show. 31, rawr, taking dominion like the great beings you are. And 13, Christ consciousness, learning who we really are, our supernatural, natural self. This is June 8th, 2015. And let's start with a little shake-up.
Hey, Lily's here. Hello.
Hi. She's playing a
hi there.
Music for us.
Okay.
Here. Welcome to the Diamonds Forever 31 show, and just wanted to send out thank yous, like I always do, to Joe, who uploads the Diamond shows in Minnesota here, IQDcalls.com, DinarGuruNews.com, YouTube, Facebook, TSU, Ashtar Command, and co-host Lily, Daniel, Cynthia, Chris, and all of our guests, special guests that we have on. Thank you, all of you guys. And also, can't forget our ET brothers and sisters, multidimensional-wise, galactic-wise, and on Earth-wise in different dimensions. Welcome you all, because they do come here, you guys. We engage with them here, building intimate relationships and moving towards co-creating together in the golden age, a beautiful world. Like Cynthia says, wrapped with supreme happiness, maximum efficiency, minimum effort. Take those that phrase into your heart and shine, diamond, shine. Okay, and also we are going to have an extra second call coming up here, not this Thursday, but next Thursday. Let us see, that is June 18th, next Thursday. Before that, Monday's call, the Diamonds call next week. And then next week, Thursday, June 18th, an extra Diamonds call. We'll have that. I'll be talking more about that next Monday. Okay, and then don't forget about the Diamonds Blogspot to catch up on the world changes and learning who you really are. Sorry. Have an incense here. My throat is tickling. So that's Diamonds with an S forever 31.blogspot.com. Now, on the right-hand side is a big diamond. That's our original YouTube channel. And above it is our second YouTube channel. You'll find all the shows on there. And just recent shows, I did a private call with my friend Tracy in Arizona, and she read some past life cards and fairy cards, and that's pretty interesting. It's about an hour long. That's reference number 240 on the recorded line, the Diamonds recorded line. You can listen to this show right after the call and all 240 shows dial the recorded line 209-255-1099, PIN number 8832-67#, and Tracy and my call is number 240#. Another recent one, tonight's reference number is 241#. And be sure to listen, to, if you haven't, to the most recent Rainbow Diamonds Council. It was extraordinary. That's the Rainbow Diamonds Council number 3, and that's on a different recorded playback line. We're getting it uploaded to YouTube. It's soon to come. That recorded line is 712-775-7029. The PIN, 629-238-518#. And that's reference number 2#. So I'll say the number again, 712-775-7029, PIN 629-238-518#, reference 2#. It's also blogged on the Diamonds blog. All right, and let's see if Lily's here yet. Star 6, Lily. Lily Diamond, come on in.
I'm here.
There you are. I was looking for you. Are you doing okay? Did you get caught up in something?
No, I'm here.
Did you get it caught up in a diamond?
No, what happened was I went to get one phone. It was ringing, but I was trying to dial into the show.
Okay.
And then
so
I'd go to the
just,
other one, and it would be...
Oh, yeah, it was me. So before Lily comes on, I wanted to bring a little thing, an update today. And there is a donation button, please. I really need help. Donations, don't need energy back in kind. Hit the donation button on the right side of the blog. Goes through PayPal, and really appreciate that. I was going to say something, but I forgot. Oh, well. And also, we're asking for donations for this conference coming up with our dear friend Franco Di Nicolo. And Lily will be reading the conference and the title of it. And he has in the past, he does live conferences at the Kingdom Center in Canada, and they have it live stream. So we can get it for live stream, but I'm going to need help. And if we just get it one time, Franco's always let us play it on the Diamonds line. It's a two-day conference, and it's very good. So see what you think. Excuse me, if you have it in your heart. Donate on the donate button and then in the note or subject for the Franco Di Nicolo conference, so I know it's for that. So, Lily, go ahead and tell about that.
Okay, so it's listed on the website of it's on Franco Di Nicolo, but it's much more clear on Masterpiece Life, which is Antonia Hagen's, and it is masterpiecelife.com. /summer 2015 retreat. And it's featuring Franco Di Nicolo, James Fu, and Antonia Hagens is helping to host that. It is occurring on Friday, this coming Friday, the 12th, Saturday, the 13th, and the 14th. And what its title is, Creating a New World Template Retreat Designed to Assist You too, and there's some bullet points I'd like to read. There's about 10 of them. It's called, it's better, what it does is it better navigates from the old world to the new unity consciousness, to live in a higher state of consciousness, navigate from within to make more conscious choices. And these are all the benefits from if you choose to indulge. Create a new inner template that supersedes adopted beliefs, programs, and patterns. Experience unity consciousness. Live in a more conscious, unified way as we collectively transform our world and playground. Let go of the old 3D world and create a path into the fourth and fifth dimensions. Connect at different energy planes. Energy travels at different energy planes. And this is something interesting that I had forgotten about it. I had read about it before. But your energy travels at different energy planes above your crown, 8 inches equals the alpha state. 3 feet is the gamma state. 6 feet is the medicine man state, which is collective healing. You will personally connect to a high level where you can access an energetic template that assists you to retune and recalibrate your body, now giving you new instructions to your cells. So once it's recalibrated, those new instructions, you know, are downloaded into the cells. The pineal third eye update process to open up in accordance with what serves you best. It opens additional chakra wheels to create connections on all levels. And there's much, much more. And what it is, a full retreat includes all sessions, meals, and snacks for $460 for those of you that can jump on a plane last minute and get up there to Kings, Ontario, Canada. Saturday only includes all sessions, meals, and snacks for $229. Sunday only includes all sessions, meals, and snacks for $159. And the live video stream, which we would like to do, is from the comfort of your own home or live stream, you know, via through the Diamonds call, $99. So that's pretty much.
And can you give the dates?
Yeah, it's
for the live stream.
For the live stream, I think that was Friday the 12th. Ooh, let me go back to the website.
Friday
evening. Can you, Liz, can you talk a little bit about, like, who Franco is and who, James Fu, what he does?
Yeah.
While
Okay, Franco Di Nicolo is a unified soul, meaning all of his multidimensional cells, which we are multidimensional cells, we have lots of us, each of us, are all healed and unified together. And so he was one of others that have different kind of jobs that was that chose to come here to help with this going into the golden age and help building us up so we can walk through it in ease. He's very awesome. James Fu is an Asian man. I forgot what country, but he, a beautiful soul. He is an energy master, what you call an energy master, and he actually does silent energy healing, you know, of different body parts and different things on Masterpiece Life with Antonio. And there's many recordings of that and Franco's activations on there. And his grandkids are growing up like him, and he's always had a real sense of energy healing, really supernatural stuff going on with his grandkids. We had a call. And the Diamonds, there's a call with James Fu on the Diamonds YouTube channel, the one with the diamond on the blog, and then there's many calls with Franco if you want to get to know him more. Beautiful, beautiful, loving souls.
Okay, I've got the website pulled up. It doesn't specify, but when you pay for the $99 for the live stream, it is the 3 days. You have access to those 3 days.
Okay, so Friday evening it starts or during the day?
So
while she's looking, if we do get donations, all we need is, you know, like 10 people, $10, $15, and put in the subject line for the Franco Di Nicolo event. We will then come to the Diamonds call, and we will play it live, and we'll announce the time and everything if we get enough donations on next Monday's call. How's that? Okay.
Yeah, it says that the retreat starts at 7:30 p.m., but it doesn't.
So I'm sure the live stream will probably start on Friday evening sometime, but we'll get the details next on Monday.
Yeah.
Anything else you'd like to share, Lily?
Excuse me?
We have a banquet, a feast tonight of all kinds of different diamond facets, different diamonds. It's going to be great. And I just wanted to know if there's anything else you'd like to share.
I think that, I did speak to you earlier today, and I happened to mention it, but I had gone to the bank earlier. It was kind of strange because there was a couple of guys, security at the bank, Bank of America. They had two security, and, like, I didn't see one of those big trucks, you know, where they collect the money and pick it up and move it around.
There were two security guards at the bank, front of the bank when you walked in, yes.
Yeah, and I forgot to to say something because I was busy and there was people, you know, in front of me and coming in and going out. But you had suggested, oh, go back and find out what they were. But what
yeah.
at once I
saw I
them,
suggested
I took
she go
notice.
Back into the bank and walk through the door and say, stop at the security guards. Oh, hi. Wow. I never seen you guys here before. Why are you here? And if they don't tell her, go to the checker and just check on your bank account and get your, you know, how much money's in your bank and then say, oh, by the way, I never seen security guards here before. Why are they there? You'll get an answer. Be the Miss Investigator,
yeah, I didn't
Lily
know
Diamond.
Special coming or going that was going to, I don't know. But what I did take notice of, there were other banks along my route that I took notice to look to see if there were people standing outside. Or, and there were two other banks, and there was, like, they didn't have security guards.
Absolutely. So what, maybe Daniel have an idea of that, or Amethyst is here, or anybody else. You know, just curious. If I was there, I'd drag you back to that bank, and I'd just do all the talking then, Lily. Anyway, that's kind of fun. So thanks for bringing that in.
Well, we know
you
who to talk to, don't we?
You know I would drag you. Remember what we did to, what's his name, in 5D, what's his name? The blonde guy, the blonde beach boy.
Greg.
Yeah, we went to the Florida conference. We got in the hotel, got in the elevator, and we noticed Greg from his picture on Blog Talk, and I said, shh, don't say nothing. So he got in with all his camera equipment and went upstairs, and then all of a sudden he got off before we did, and we said, have a good day, and we said his name. What's his name again? Oh, my God, I forgot it.
Greg.
Have a good day, Greg. And he looked at us like astounded, like we knew his name because we're strangers. But, yeah, that was fun. Mm-hmm. We had fun for bringing up some memories, right, Lily?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, stay tuned and add in anytime you want.
Thank you.
You're welcome, hon. All right. So I just want to do the law of one, the law that trumps all laws, even our laws here on Earth, and that Cynthia's taught us that. She's a beautiful soul. She's here tonight, too. Cynthia, I'll just pray it, and I want everybody to unmute, and then we'll pray that short prayer together. Just repeat after Cynthia. So first of all, I want to say, and you guys can ask me about what this means if you're curious. I want to say, I trust all consciousnesses here that are here tonight that will listen. I call forth the highest consciousness I am. And so then we'll just start in the prayer of one. I call in the divine flame of living love. I call in collective consciousness. I call in all our ET brothers and sisters who we've already engaged with and building relationship. I call in all others that are interested to listen or to engage with us. And I just love everybody. I'm a loss for words tonight. So, and we just ask for the highest good of all concerned of all of us engaging tonight in conversation and relationship, human to human, human to star brother and sister, and everybody else, and our guides. We call in all our guides, the spiritual court of equity of our ancestors. And we call in 360 angels assigned around each 360 degrees around the earth. And we call in all others that would like to come, good or bad, as we say, because we love you all. And so, Cynthia, is there anything else you want to say? And then you can
yeah,
say the prayer.
Yeah, I want to just do a little bit of a lead into the law of one.
Okay, sure. And then when Cynthia says ready to go, she'll say the phrase, and then we'll repeat after her. I believe the room is unlocked, so I'll just make sure everybody's unmuted. Go ahead, Cynthia.
Yeah, it was amazing that Lily mentioned. It was amazing that Lily mentioned. Oh dear. I'm sorry.
Okay.
I jumped the gun. I'll get used to this one of these days. a lot of banks are going to close in the Jade Helm exercise area. Bank of America is one of them. Lots of different ones are closing in that area that they're doing the exercise in. In 8 or 9 days, I think they're closing on June 16th.
closing for good?
What the article said is that they're going to close, and then they're going to claim that it was a virus, and then they'll say, you're okay, we'll be open again, and then give a date.
Oh, okay.
But
and
they
what's
are
Jade
closing.
Helm?
They're
what's
all
Jade
closing
Helm?
The same day that Jade Helm officially starts.
What's Jade Helm?
Jade Helm,
just
you
for the
don't
record.
Know?
No,
it's,
just for the record.
It's this huge military exercise that's being done all over the state of Texas, and there's this huge area they're doing it in. It may even be a number of states. You just type in Jade Helm. And the militaries, the militias, let me put it that way, are all up in arms. Texas has put all kinds of safeguards in place. There's just lots of pro and con chatter on the Internet about whether it's the bad guys or the good guys, or the bad guys or the good guys are taking over, you know, whether it's going to be this horrible scenario or that wonderful scenario. There's just all this stuff going around and about and up and down and in and out. And being Mercury retrograde, you can just imagine the chaos out there around Jade Helm. But huge amounts of military have been moving in, military equipment for months. I mean, it's just been amazing what's been going on out there. And a lot of people speculate it's because there's going to be the announcements, and they're there to protect everybody. Because even though it's being announced that it's in that area of the country, there's similar stuff happening in other states. It's just not being announced. But at any event, when we do the Law of One, I want to specifically target all these goings on Earth. Now, we know a little bit about Jade Helm. There's probably tons we don't know about. And there's the good guys who are trying to save the Earth and bring about, you know, abundance and health and restore the environment. And then there's the guys, you know, who are creating the problem that's bringing us all together as one to work together. And I just, when we say the Law of One, I want to target both equally.
Okay.
Because we are one, and they are us, and we are them. And it's just a part of us. That they're representing
Absolutely.
A part of us. And it's the part of us that sabotages our own selves. It's the, we all have selves that believe in ourselves. We want the very best for ourselves. And then we have selves that may be angry or may be depressed or may be cynical.
Oh, I think, Amethyst, you're unmuted. If you could star six, please, really quick, and then we'll unstar.
Yeah, I can end this up real quick if you want me to. But the thing is, we as children of God, we have within us everything. We have within us absolutely everything that's in creation inside of us. We are fractals. And those parts of ourselves that represent the skeptic, the, you know, maybe into greed or lust or who knows what else, those parts are being acted out on the bigger screen by our brothers and sisters who are, you know, trying to exterminate 90% of the people on the planet because of their
Absolutely.
Belief systems and this and that. And then you can take the greatest avatars. You can take Jesus. You can take Buddha, all those. We have those in us, too. And we have the plant kingdom and the mineral kingdom and the animal kingdom. Everything is within us. So when we do the Law of One, we're doing everything inside of us that is reflected in everything outside of us. And
That's
when
awesome.
We look at it that way, the ones who deserve it the least, according to our logical minds, are the ones who need it the most.
Okay, say that sentence again. We are
the ones that
praying
we
for the, no, the reflection inside of us, outside of us. Say that again.
Yeah, we're asking for the highest good of everything inside of us and all the reflections of that on the outside of us.
That's beautiful.
Yeah.
Okay, and we want to add to the Jade Helm thing and all what you said, too.
And
right?
Also, the other thing I want to add with specific attention to is there's all these negotiations going on with ETs, and there's vast numbers of different ones, and they're at different stages of evolution. And there's a bunch of them that are kind of like mid-level, and this is my interpretation, who are negotiating with the dark guys. And the dark guys
Absolutely.
Are saying, but wait, these people have given their consent for everything we're doing. And what we need to do with the law of one is say, no, this was not informed consent. A lot of this was done when we were born with our birth certificates, and we couldn't consent to anything. We couldn't even understand the language, and our grandparents in the same way, and that the only thing we consent to, and you can change this if you don't agree, but I'm just suggesting it, the only thing we consent to is the highest good of all concern, the law of one.
And that's the law of one. And by the way, yes, there is negotiations with ETs involved, I mean drastically involved, more as much as the humans are. And I did an automatic writing the other day. It's on the Rainbow Diamonds Rainbow Council number 3, and I read it on another call. And this is actually an ET, lack of better words, limousine driver who's transferring ETs and humans, CEOs in this world reset, back and forth to meetings. You know, they take cars too, but these are, so I know that's true, yeah, amongst other things.
And so what I would like to float before everybody, you know, this is just my suggestion, is that we as a council tonight are representatives of the whole planet, and as representatives of the whole planet, speaking for the whole planet, because in the ET laws they say that a real inhabitant of a planet can ask on behalf of the rest of the planet. So as a council, we are officially declaring that all consent, previous, implied, or by accident, or anything that we've made is now being upgraded. It's being updated. It's being just upgraded to the law of one, that the only thing we're consenting to is
Absolutely.
The highest good of all concerned.
And I want to say, as a council, and those who join us tonight live and the ones that listen are part of the council. And
yes.
What I've gotten recently, we're going to put it this way, what we're doing tonight, what you are participating in tonight. And I hear ETs on the phone. Hi, ETs, I love you. If you want to speak, can we pray the law of one, and then we'll see if you
want
to come in.
Let's do the law of one. Okay,
just... wait a minute. I want to say this is what we're doing tonight. We're seeing through all eyes. We're
yeah.
hearing through all ears. We're being the voice. Then, okay, now let me unlock the room, Cynthia, and then everybody repeat mm-hmm. after Cynthia, the law of one.
Okay, sweet people, I love you, and I'm so excited and honored to be doing this with you. It's historical. We've worked many, many lifetimes to meet together tonight and do this law on behalf of the whole planet, and actually, we can actually do it on behalf of the whole creation, just because that's the way the law works. But I'm going to say a sentence, and then you repeat after me, and this is the law. Here it goes. We are all one.
We are all one.
When one is harmed, all are harmed.
No, I didn't win.
When one is harmed, all are harmed.
When one is helped, all are helped.
When one is helped, all are helped.
Therefore, in the name of who I am.
Therefore, in the name of who I am.
And I am one with all there is.
And I am one with all there is.
I ask that only the highest good.
I ask that only the highest good.
Of all concerned happen. And I give thanks that this is done.
And I give thanks that this is done.
So be it. That's it, folks. We did
thank
it.
Thank you that this is done. Thank you. Okay, hold on, guys. Thank you, Cynthia. Thank you so much. And just stay tuned here. All right, now we have Mr. T here as a special guest. We're going to do our Forever Forward News, Mr. T, and then we'll get to you. And Tracy, I wanted to see if you're here. Come on, star 6, and say hi if you're on the moderator line. Angel, Sydney, are you here? And to star 6, just say hi. Let me unlock the room if somebody's on the other side, too. Okay, Angel, Sydney, or Tracy, are you here? Star 6. And I know Mr. T's here. And I know Annie's here. All right. Okay, well, we'll see.
Can you hear me, Elizabeth?
There you are, Tracy. Okay,
yeah,
stay tuned. You're coming up.
Okay.
Thank you. Let me read this. And Lily, are you there? Lily?
I'm here.
Can you give Daniel a quick call or text him?
Yep.
Maybe he forgot somehow. Okay, thank you. All right, there was a new Benjamin Fulford report that came out. Ah, there you are. There you are. Thank you.
Yeah, I've been here on the call. For some reason, I'm having problems with my earplugs. Hold on. Because I can't.
Okay.
I'm not going to talk with my phone sitting on my head. I had to dial in. Let me put my headset in. Hold on.
Okay, sure.
Okay, my headset must have been killed.
Oh, okay. Do you mind if I read these three little paragraphs of Benjamin Fulford real quick?
But before I do that, how does this sound? Because if this doesn't sound good, then I'm not going to be on the call tonight. I'll just yell this apart. I'll be a part.
It sounds great.
How does this sound? Let me do the
great.
Then let me do my point and get done with it then.
Okay,
I've been trying to get on the call now for 5 minutes. My headset's been gone out. No, it's not about. It's my fault.
Okay,
are you
go
ready?
Go for it. Daniel, Forever Forward News, come on in.
Yeah, sorry for the technical difficulty, folks. It's a headset-related issue. All right. Oh, great call so far, guys. I'm feeling the love, too, with what's going on with the planetary alignment, what you guys were discussing earlier. Jade Helm, I want to put the kibosh on that, like Cynthia's talking about. There's a lot of fear porn on the internet about Jade Helm going on out there, folks. It's just a military operation. It happens to deal with cyber attacks and all that kind of stuff to include the banking business. Don't worry about it and don't fret about it, okay? It's just a military exercise. If you happen to be in a state of Texas that is just loaded with Army bases and military bases, primarily where this is probably taking place, you might see some people in your banks or something like that. But as far as Jade Helm concerned, don't really worry about it unless you see your neighbors getting apprehended and they're pulling people out of their houses, okay, and then loading them up on the boxcars, trains, and bringing them into the smokehouses. Don't fret about Jade Helm. A lot of it internet porn. It's a military operation. Is it RV-related? Who knows? But don't worry about that. Okay, good news. The vice – you're there, right, Elizabeth? I just want to touch base. I'm not talking of dead air. You're there, right, Elizabeth?
I'm here.
Did you hear about Joe Biden's son?
No. Tell me.
Okay. Well, that's good. So you weren't really aware of Jade Helm. And I only haven't mentioned it in the last couple months because I thought everybody was aware. But it's just a military exercise. Joe Biden's son. Joe Biden is the vice president of the United States of this wonderful country, Elizabeth. One of Joe Biden's sons passed away last week. Isn't that fantastic? I thought that was, God rest his soul, but I thought that was the most fantastic news when I heard that. And here's the reason why I'm saying this, and I'm being very facetious, folks. The cabal, the people, the bad people, the thems, the people that have just kind of, that entity that's been on this planet doing ugly things to us. Because remember, we allowed it to happen to us, and we're taking our power back, and we're managing us now from ever going forward because we're wonderful people, and we're in charge of us. Those people that were manipulating us yesterday because they're not in charge of us today, we are in charge of us today. Those son of a bitches that were doing that shit to everybody on this planet yesterday, well, I hate to say it, folks, their children are passing away from illness, disease, famine, you know, implants, all the same crap that our people, you and I, my brothers, my sisters, my neighbors are dying from. Well, now it's happening to the elite. So when I found out about that, Elizabeth, the first question that came to Daniel's head as a military man, which one of Joe Biden's children passed away?
Well, you know what that story reminds me of? You know what that's right there, what you just described?
I know. Don't interrupt me. Listen, I'm not done. This is a point here. He has two sons, Elizabeth. He has two sons. So the first question that came to my mind, he has one son that had a learning disability. okay? And then he had another son that was a veteran, an Iraq war veteran that came back, and somehow he had somehow got some sort of terminal disease, cancer or something. So I didn't know which one passed away, and it happened to be the veteran. And I was like, bingo, home run, grand slam. It's happening to everybody who's gone overseas, okay? And it's happening to the elite's children. Don't be surprised if Prince Harry gets it next. The whole Middle East is contaminated with uranium, okay? And they know it. And they have to fix it, and they can fix it very easily. Remember, this is a loving call. The beautiful thing about this is it's now happening to the elite's children. So they're looking at the world like us. They're getting up, and they're spinning around 13 times 28 plus 1, just like you and I. And they're sitting here in the world, and they're understanding, what the hell are we doing, folks? When I pass, I'm leaving nothing for my heirs. So whatever my supervisors are telling me to do, this isn't working anymore. The United States of America, the United States president, the vice president of the United States are low people on the totem pole, on the chopping block of what the hell's going on in this 3D reality. Be excited, folks. The blessing is about to come. Now I'm going to end up in 5 minutes, Elizabeth, because it really wasn't about Joe Biden. It wasn't anything. Specific. It's about all of the suffering. We're all equally suffering. Nobody is elite. Nobody is immune from the suffering. Because the suffering, remember that person, remember that person. What'd you call me the other night, Elizabeth? You called me a jackass. Remember that, Elizabeth? You called me that jackass? I agree. Everything in this jackass is right, exactly. All fun and love. You call me a jackass. And I agreed, Elizabeth. Everything that this jackass did, and I'm pointing a finger at me, folks, it's my fault. And all the glory and all the wonderful things, it's my fault too. And I stand in my skin suit, right? I stand in my skin suit here right now, folks, with you on this call, and I'm taking my power back. And there is no limits. You are a limitless being. Now I'm going to describe quickly, very quickly, a physical experience, a physics experiment just completed. Or not completed, I'm in the process of. I'm 4 days into a 4-day physics experience.
Oh, you broke up. What did you say? You broke up.
Is this better?
Yeah,
I'm in a 4-day physical experience. Here's the experience. I'm 50 years old. I have no idea who I am. I don't know my potential. I'm taking the ignorant road in life, and I'm taking the position that I don't know anything, and I'm the life of the child. For 4 days now, as a 50-year-old child, for 4 days now, Elizabeth, I ran 7 miles. 7 miles, 4 days in a row. Yesterday was 3 days. I did 7 miles, 3 days in a row. And I had a conversation with my mother. This old Marine had a conversation with my mother yesterday. Says, Mother, do you know how many times or when the last time is I ever ran 3 days in a row where I ran 7 miles or more? She says, when? I says, never. So I took the experiment and I said, I'm going to try to run 7 miles today. And I ran 7 miles today. So I'm resting, I'm properly eating, and I'm doing it. And I'm going to try it again tomorrow until I break myself. Or at least get myself to a position, Elizabeth, that my body's telling me, okay, now rest. I know what I'm doing, folks, so don't really worry about me. The reason why I'm telling you this wonderful, crazy experiment is I want you to start pushing yourself. Stop putting boundaries on you. You're an amazing, beautiful human soul. You can do anything. If I can do my silly 4 days at 7 miles, and tomorrow I'm going to try for my fifth, And it's just my silly game that I'm playing with myself. Even though Elizabeth called me a jackass, this donkey loves the game he's playing. I want you to play a similar game, and I want you to play with your own donkey and have fun out there. Seriously, have fun. If you woke up today and you didn't have fun, shame on you. Shame on you. But don't worry about it, folks, because I'll guarantee you one thing. Depending on what part of the country you're in and what part of the world you're in, when you close your eyes tomorrow and you wake up, the sun's going to come out again. It's just because the planet spun a little bit more, and there's the sun. So don't worry about today. If you had a shitty day, even if somebody passed away today, don't worry about it. Go forward. All right, Elizabeth, that's all I got. But Jade Helm, don't worry about it. It's just another military fun zone.
Thanks a lot, Daniel. Now I can't help myself. Out of stories, sometimes I can see signs and wonders that makes you wonder. I got a sign and wonder for both your stories. So the Joe Biden and his son and just say, you know, elite family. You know what story that reminds me of, Daniel? It reminds me of the Bible story with Pharaoh in Egypt and Moses. Let my people go. Shook Pharaoh. Nope. Sent, I don't know, was it 4 or 7 different days worth of curses to the Pharaoh. Let my people go. Nope. I'm stubborn. I got big pride and ego. Nope. Let my people go. No. Let my people go. No. Let my people go. Okay, a little bit. No, come back. Let my people go. The last thing that God sent in the story of Moses to Pharaoh, because he was stubborn and wouldn't let my people go, guess what it was? It was their children. His son, Pharaoh's son, baby son, died. So that's a sign of wonder, makes you wonder. The last thing before Pharaoh, upon Moses asking, before Pharaoh let him go, was that. Think about that. That's a sign and a wonder. We're there. It's a foot. And also, you're running 7 miles, and, you know, we're a prophetic act. We're a vibration. Even us marching on the ground, we do something to change.
Don't jinx my running, because I'm going to try for 7 days in a row, but I'm not going to say it out loud. I got to get to number 5.
Yeah.
Trust me.
Yeah.
I have a 50-year-old back. Don't even say it. Don't say it.
You're running 7 miles a day. I was just going to bring in that 7 means Jubilee. So when we're tuning forks, and I was going to bring this in earlier, everybody's a tuning fork. So there's some little ones, medium ones, big ones. That's all in the vibration, high vibration you're at. And a big tuning fork tuned a little tuning forks. So anyway, that's a sign of wonder, makes you wonder. All right.
All right. Well, I love you guys all, and I'll get back on the call later tonight, but I don't have good audio equipment today, and I apologize. I love you guys. I'll talk to you later. Thanks, Elizabeth.
Thanks. You sound great.
Elizabeth?
Okay, and then I wanted to bring Amethyst in if she had anything really quick, and Marianne, I hear you.
Yeah. Can I add something?
Sure.
Do you know anything about John Kerry? U.S. Secretary of State John Kerry.
He lived in Minnesota and was in a plane crash, apparently a plane crash by accident. I don't think so. No, I'm thinking of somebody else. Okay, go ahead really quick because we've got a big show here. Mr. T, we're getting to you. I didn't forget about you and everybody else.
Recently, past Sunday, May 31st, he was gravely wounded during a gun battle with what has been described as Islamic State of Iraq and ISIS assassins. And they're reporting that it was a bike accident, they're saying, but...
Right. Kind of like what happened with Hillary Clinton when she fell.
Yeah.
So there's something going on. So that's, you know, a sign and a wonder whether that story's true, but something went on that he had to stay away from the world. Yeah.
That's it. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for bringing that on. That's great. Okay, and Amethyst, did you have anything to add regarding the news, really quick? I know you called me. Just star six, Amethyst, if you're there.
Okay, well, this is Amethyst. Well, I think that, it was actually an assassination attempt on John Kerry because evidently his cohorts were angry at his Iranian deal-making. So I just assumed that it was some of his Illuminati cohorts that were angry at him and had thing about the bike accident, I think that was just a cover story, so it was an assassination attempt.
Okay, and I had two things this week that people text me about, maybe Daniel or Amethyst or Marianne or anybody on there. Two other strange things going on. A local man here in Minnesota went to buy silver coins, silver blocks. They would not let him buy it because there's a Minnesota embargo in the coin dealers or something like that. That's kind of strange. Never heard of that. And then also, there was a dinar site that, it didn't say it shut down, but it stopped taking orders, stopped taking payments for a while. I don't know if it's how long they're going to.
Sterling Currency Group.
So anything in a nutshell regarding that? I mean, I don't want to bring the fear in, but anybody have any ideas what's going on with those two things? Lots of changes afoot, lots of rearranging stuff.
Yeah. Elizabeth, let me interject here real quick. This call can go down a rabbit hole. There's so much going on right now. Let's close the news right now. Let's go on with the call because there's so much on the agenda tonight. And let's focus on the love because we're bringing the love and the changes. There is a lot of ugliness,
okay,
but let's not talk about that right now. This is a suggestion.
Yes, and I just wanted to – I was going to read the three paragraphs of Benjamin Fulford just came out today, but I'll read the title and I'll kind of give you the gist of it regarding the nations, the G7, and how Benjamin talks about most of the nations are going towards the good side, and I'll just put it that way. And the title of it is G7 Helpless in the Face of Mathematically Certain Bankruptcy. So that bankruptcy of the IMF, of the, the debt money and IRS and all that, which, Kennedy was going to put in the real money. So that's basically very much heating up. And so that's blogged. I blogged that. It's on the blog spot. You guys can go read that.
And Elizabeth,
right,
let me just quickly add, because of what Daniel said, today Venus is at the exact place of the ecstasy and rapture of love.
Wow.
In the 360 degrees circling the Earth today, Venus. And Venus is like super big as far as what happens.
Okay,
so
Cynthia, do you want to do your piece now, like for 10, 12 minutes? Is that good? And
is
then
that okay?
We've been in an hour in. And then we'll bring on our guest, Mr. T. And I have Tracy who's going to read, do some cards for all of us today, a couple. It takes 10 minutes or so. But we'll... It's Cynthia and then Mr. T and then Tracy.
Well, I'll read the Rapture of Love then.
Yes, go ahead.
Excuse me. It's not only the Rapture of Love, but it's also the Angel. It's between 3 and 4 degrees Leo, which is the 3 degrees Leo is the Angels of Love and Rapture, and 4 degrees Leo is the Angels of the Elements. And so what I'm going to do, since we all know what love and rapture is, I'm going to read the elements because this has to do with saving our Earth. This says, beloved, we help people understand the four elements as they express in nature. Now remember, this is united with the rapture of love. So just bleed what you know of the ecstasy and rapture of divine love into what I'm reading now. We help people understand the four elements as they express in nature. As you know, everything in manifest creation pictures godlike qualities. The grandeur, the beauty, the intelligence, the exquisite perfection of the Almighty is present in even the least of the objects of divine handiwork. The more that scientists and philosophers contemplate the intricate perfection of creation, the more that divine intelligence becomes obvious. We teach how to understand and use the four elements of fire, air, water, and earth as they exist in the natural world. These four elements contain within them an echo secrets of the fourfold nature of divine being, and therefore of man and woman, who are made in the image and likeness of God. The element of fire expresses divine will. The element of air expresses divine thoughts and mind. The element of water expresses divine emotions. And the element of earth, the five senses, the divine senses. By studying the qualities of the four elements and how they evolve one into the other, keys to creation are revealed through analogy. This is why it was written that God's handiwork in nature is the book in which is written all wisdom and all understanding for the seeker who comprehends that creation is the expression of divine consciousness and is the actual out-picturing of divine consciousness. We, the angels of the elements, the angels of Mahra, guide enlightenment step by step as each person studies the four elements of nature with the intent of penetrating the secrets of creativity. As people prove themselves to be harmless, we open deep secrets written in the elements and their relationships one to another. Such people will come to understand their own true natures as sons and daughters of God, and also the nature of all that is. Hearts that flow with divine emotions and value wisdom and love above all else, that carefully safeguard the use of willpower, knowing that all is one, shall know the truth. Fire and the beings of fire, the salamanders are electrical will and form. Fire is the original masculine power of will, intent, and electricity. It is generated in the sons and daughters of God in the delta frequency of pure being. Will enters the mind, which is thought. Air and the beings of air, the sylphs, are thought and form. Thought is generated in the theta frequency of the inner child. Will and thought, or fire and air, are masculine expressions of divine consciousness or spirit. As fire or will passes through thought, the electrical energy eventually becomes magnetic and turns into flowing emotion. Water and the beings of water, the undines, are magnetic in form. Water is the original feminine principle of attraction and magnetism. It is generated in our alpha brainwaves of our adolescent selves. Emotions, along with the earth element and its beings, the gnomes, attract form in the beta state of the five senses, memory, and logic. Emotions and form are water and earth are feminine expressions of the divine consciousness or soul. So fire and air are spirit, and emotions and sensation are soul. Altogether, the four elements of fire, air, water, and earth are electromagnetic, the male and the female energy of the unified field, the web of life. We teach how miracles in nature are brought about through the use of will and emotion in meditation. Mahra instructs in the magic of elements, which enable a child of God to make practical use of the electromagnetic fluids in nature. Come with us, the angels of the elements, as we teach of the mysteries of the elements in nature and the miracles that are possible in their use. In doing so, learn of the nature of divine consciousness and therefore how to produce miracles in the physical bodies of everything in creation, in the world, the control of storms, of volcanoes, of all the elements, and especially in man and woman who are made in the image and likeness of God. So on that note, we can continue forward. We are moving into a time where we are going to be walking the earth as regal royalty, as actual manifestations, as sons of God and daughters of God, with full dominion and full use of all of our chakras. We will be medicine men. We will be shaman. We will be saints. We will be masters of miracles. And the women, those of us who have incarnated in feminine form, we will be the masters of emotion and of physical form, and the men who are God manifesting in masculine form will be the masters of will and intent and thought. And together, we will come together in the rapture of love so that you have the will, the thought, the emotion, and the form constantly in a state of perfect balance and harmony and love, mystical love, the rapture of divine cosmic love. So back to you, Elizabeth.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, my God. Thank you, Cynthia. And stay tuned, please, if you can.
I'll stay on for a while, yes.
Okay. Thank you so much. That was beautiful. I want to just take a deep breath here. I'm talking mostly to myself. I don't want to rush. I don't want to seem be rushed. There's people that call me sometimes at the last minute and want to get into the Diamond Show because they have something to share and offer, and I will not refuse that. I'm not going to do it because of ego's sake and build the show, and no. I'm not going to refuse it because, you know, women are mostly magnetic, and if they come to me, a woman, and I must have drawn them for humanity, and because that's my heart, the world, and beyond. So I just bear with us, Mr. T. Bear with us, and everybody bear with us, and we're just going to just relax, take a deep breath. I'm talking to myself, and we're just going to enjoy every moment in the now of everything, this banquet tonight. And also, you know, we're in the heart chakra, so women are magnetic and electric, both, just as men are magnetic and electric. I learned this from Cynthia, but we're in the heart chakra, so women are being electric in this month from... What is this, June? It was from May 22nd to June 21st, and then July 22nd to August 21st, then the men will be back to electric. It's not a long story, but Cynthia's talked about it before, and I'm glad you talked about that. So everybody just sit back, relax, enjoy the ride, and talking to myself. So thanks, Cynthia. Hang around if you can. I love you to come back in, too. And we have... Tracy and Annie and Sydney Angel, are you there? I just want to see if she's there. We're going to bring on Mr. T, and then Tracy and Sydney, if she's there. Let me just see if she's there. So, okay, Sydney, are you there? Sydney Angel. All right. So, and then we have Annie too. All right. Okay, let me introduce Mr. T, our guest tonight, and he has a new spot called Mr. Truth Seeker, Ascension and World News, Information and Preparation for the New Earth. And let me read his bio, but I just want to say, talking about signs and wonders makes you wonder today. Mr. T, I was driving down the street today. I was talking on the phone, driving the car. I happened to look up, driving down the street I drive down, and I looked up, and it was Mr. T's auto body. So I said, yeah. And then I looked, and right away I looked to the left. There was a sign that said Namaste. So I know you're supposed to be here tonight.
Sounds like you're getting some messages.
Yeah, absolutely. Let me just read this. Yeah. I'll just read what Mr. Potter wrote on his website that you post on, which is thepromiserevealed.com/Mr. Truth Seeker, or you can go to the web and put in go to the tab News, and you'll find Mr. Truth Seeker Ascension and World News. And dear Promise family, it is my honor and my pleasure to introduce you to the dear friend and fellow lightworker who we will call Mr. Truth Seeker. He was a member of Dr. Frank Strange's Inner Circle meetings. I met him in Las Vegas, where we both talked to a crew member from Victor 1 Commander Valiant Thor's flagship at one meeting. Mr. Truth Seeker compiles an incredible amount of information every day on a variety of subjects, and he has kindly consented to use my website to keep you all informed. I will openly declare that I will not agree to endorse every single post he makes, nor will I address the accuracy of every report he posts. You are all responsible to determine what messages resonate with you in your heart. I then suggest you use your own discernment to research the truth for yourself and decide on your own, in your heart, if these news updates and lightworker messages resonate with your heart. Go within where all truth resides. May these reports and messages inspire and uplift us all in preparation for the new earth and new golden age. You will find on this page an amazing number of reports to encourage us towards a spiritual realization of the whole truth nothing but the truth. I added that. As we work towards our personal ascension, warm regards, Rob Potter. And let me read these titles that he has, tons of articles. Personal and Urgent Updates, Health, USA, International, New Financial System, GCR, Space, Science, Technology, Lightworker Messages, Personal Development. Wow, Mr. Truth Seeker, welcome. How are you tonight?
I'm doing wonderful.
You're at work for humanity. Your heart must be for humanity and this earth too, huh?
It sure is, yes. I guess you could say back in 92, I had a cousin who kept encouraging me to get a shortwave radio. And I didn't think it was all that important. I kept putting it off, but he kept bugging me. He said, man, you got to listen to these broadcasts on shortwave radio. He says, you're not getting the news. And I thought, well, I was getting the news, you know. And so after about 6 months of him pestering me, I finally broke down and bought a Grundig radio and started listening to some of the radio stations he suggested. And I couldn't believe that it was like night and day compared to what I was getting off, you know, mainstream news. And they were talking about, you know, the Illuminati, our revised history, Federal Reserve, and the whole fraud committed there. I mean, I was just getting a whole new education back in the early 90s due
wow.
to some of these patriots that were on there. And most of them were coming, of course, from a Christian perspective. I was raised as a Christian. But, you know, it kind of helped me to wake up to the dark cabal very early on in the early 90s. And when I realized that there was this dark element that was trying to dominate the world, I thought, well, I need to tell my friends. So, you know, I tried to tell my friends, and they thought I was one of these crazy conspiracy guys. So, I got a taste of that very early on. I know a lot of people now are just now still getting, you know, that from some of their friends. But I thought, well, how could I wake these people up and not lose my friends? Because we just don't see eye to eye anymore, you know. They have their own worldview, and they're comfortable in that worldview, and they don't want me to upset it. It makes them very uncomfortable. So I thought, how can I convert these guys? They got to see the truth. And I kept trying to encourage them to buy a shortwave, but I knew how slow I was in buying one. I figured, well, they're not going to jump on that. So what I decided to do is I found that a lot of the articles or a lot of the news reports that I was getting on shortwave radio was eventually finding its way on some of the alternative news websites on the Internet. And the Internet was just getting started at this time. So I started, you know, trying to take advantage of all these news sites that were kind of independent that were coming online at this time, trying to confirm anything I could find that I heard on shortwave. And I was starting to get all kinds of confirmation through various independent websites that were confirming that that there was this dark element that was controlling things. They were talk of the Illuminati and who they really were, the various secret societies, the Masons, and all that. So I thought, well, you know what I could do is we have this wonderful tool of email. Why don't I just email some of these stories over to my friends and see how that works. So what I did is I approached my friends and said, and told them, I said, you know, I'm starting to put out the news every day. How'd you like to keep up with the news? And I hardly had anybody, you know, reject and say no, they didn't want to keep up with the news. So I said, well, what I do is I send out about 4 emails every day and just to keep you up to date with what's going on. And they said, sure. I said, can I add you, you know, to my news list? And they said, sure. So I added them to my news list, and I found out that the people that, you know, wouldn't believe that hardly any of this stuff that I was trying to tell them completely were starting to change. And I found out that people change when you feed them a little bit of truth every day. You cannot bombard them because it's too much of a paradigm shift. So you have to actually give them just a little bit of truth, and it nudges them. It causes them to shift a little bit. And then you feed them a little bit more, and they shift a little more. And I found what I would do is I would send out an article that would say something that would be, it would just sound almost ludicrous. It would just almost crazy, you know, like, you know, that the government is, say, trying to sell Long Beach, you know, naval station over to the Chinese, or that we're turning all of our patents over to the Chinese. You know, I would send out articles like this, and, you know, people would say, oh, that's crazy. That can't be true. But then what I would do is I'll follow it. I would usually follow it in a day or two with another source saying the exact same thing. And then I would do it again with another source until it finally just cements in and people cannot deny the truth anymore. So I would always confirm things I would send out through other sources. You get this repetition to where you finally have to accept the fact that, hey, this must really be true with all these sources now saying this. So I found out that by sending emails, I could actually convert people over to believing this whole paradigm shift about the dark cabal and what they were trying to do behind the scenes. And it would take about anywhere between 4 to 6 months. I would have them completely converted. They would be a changed individual. They were not the same individual anymore. Now they would go into a little bit of fear mode, which everybody does initially when you find out about this. But I tried to, you know, reassure them that wouldn't you rather know the truth and be armed and prepared than be ignorant? And, you know, once they finally accept that that's the better course, then they stay on my list. I never hardly ever had anybody ever drop off my list. And so over the
beautiful strategy and wisdom, Mr. T. Go ahead.
So over the years, you know, I just continue to keep adding people to my list. I kept saying, hey, you know, I ran across somebody that I really liked and I'd like to get to know better, but I knew that they just weren't awake yet. I said, hey, how would you like to get some news every day? I send out the news every day. Can I add you to my news list? Almost everybody always says yes. And I could tell by talking to them later, at a later time, they were a different individual. They weren't the same person anymore. I usually didn't go there too much. I just, because you don't want to kind of, you don't want to rub anything in like that, or, you know, you just kind of, because they're going through a transformation, and you have to let them go through their transformation, and everybody goes through it a little bit differently. And some people actually, you know, can have a real meltdown. So you just kind of have to pray for them and just let the truth continue to do its work on them, because the truth will change everybody if they just are open to it. So I had quite a few on my news list, and I was starting to, you know, since I was brought up with Christianity in my background, you know, and the Christian Patriot radio programs I was listening to were always kind of, you know, backing up the Christian paradigm. But I knew that there was something not quite right there. And I was also starting to listen to late night radio with Art Bell. And Art Bell was always dealing with the paranormal and abductions and ETs and UFOs experiences. And I thought, well, this is really weird. I don't know how to fit this in, but it's definitely, these are real experiences. People aren't just making this stuff up. So, you know, I wanted to try to fit it into my Christian paradigm, but it just wasn't really fitting in. I continued to keep listening to Art Bell because, you know, I wanted to find the real truth on this, on all this UFO stuff. And it wasn't until he had a guest on his program in 1995 by the name of Dr. Frankie Stranges. And most of the interviews that Art Bell did with UFOs and ETs and all, it was all about abductions, people being abducted, taken on board, you know, put on a slab, prodded and probed, and you know, various fluids taken from them, and then they had these horrible experiences. And I knew that those couldn't be from the light because, you know, their free will was being violated. So this was always obviously coming from the dark. So I kind of, you know, thought, well, okay, I don't know exactly what's going on here at this time in 94, 95, but there's a dark element here, and it's definitely violating free will. So the Christian church, they pretty much try to write all this stuff off as saying I was just demonic. But I wasn't quite buying that either. That didn't fit in either because these were real ships. They were going on board. Real fluids were being taken. They had real experiences. They were encountering, you know, physical things. So it was not just demonic in some higher spiritual realm. So I continued to keep listening. And then finally had Dr. Frankie Stangis on, and he was kind of very unique because he was in touch with an ET who claimed to be from the planet Venus, and not from the surface of the planet, but from the interior. And according to Frank and other sources, all planets are hollow. That's how they're formed. And most of the civilizations live on the interior of the planets, not on the surface. And that's the case with Venus. And according to Dr. Frank, he was a Christian minister. And he started churches and was a member of an evangelical association of some kind. And early in his church days, he was also very interested in UFOs. And he had a roommate that he was rooming with who was part of the I think it was the Army Air Force. The two were combined at that time. It was just one where they had the Army and the Air Force all together. But his roommate was doing practice flights, and he relayed to him that while he was up there doing his flights, he had these silver discs fly in front of his craft, and they were doing these crazy, you know, high speeds but right angle turns. He said they were defying physics, and I tried to bring this up to the commanding officer during our debriefing, and the commanding officer said, sir, what you saw were high-flying Canadian geese. And he said, but, sir, these things were flying at high speed and doing right angle. He said, sir, shut up. What you saw were high-flying Canadian geese.
Oh, whatever, huh?
And so Dr. Strange said he knew that they couldn't be geese, so this triggered him to go on a UFO search himself. And he was gathering all kinds of pictures and anything he could get on UFOs and trying to put together the pieces. And while he was speaking in Washington, D.C., at one of the churches there, he was on a plane, and he ran into one of his friends, which was a photographer for the Air Force, and his name was Augie Roberts. And they were sitting together on the plane, and Augie said, hey, Frank, did you know that there was a being here from another planet, and it landed here in Washington, D.C.? And Dr. Strange said, Augie, what have you been smoking? And he said, no, it's real. I got photographs of him. He says, let me see him. And so he showed him the photographs, and he said, hey, they look just like us. He said, that's right, except they're a little bit different. He says, what do you mean? He says, well, when they look at you, it's like they're looking right through you. And Dr. Strange said, well, Augie, my father can do that. That's no big deal. He said, well, the commander here, Commander Thor, he said he can speak 16 different languages. He said, oh, well, that's pretty impressive. He said, what else about him? He says, well, he has no fingerprints, no fingerprints at all. Now, Dr. Strangis was also studying criminology, and he knew that you could actually, you know, tear your skin off to where you could tear your fingerprint where it wouldn't be there, but it would always come back. It always grows back. And so he said, now, this is very unusual. He said, well, can I borrow your pictures and show them at my next meeting at my church I'm going to? And he said, sure, you can borrow these pictures. So he did his typical slide presentation showing all his UFO slides. And then what happened is he said, I got a couple of pictures from a friend of mine who claims that these individuals are from another planet. They're from the planet Venus. And I'm going to put them up here for display. And if anybody would like to take a look at them, come up here. I'm going to be selling my book, Saucerama, and I'll sign your book for you. So one of the ladies went up there and said, Dr. Strangis. He said, I need to speak. She said, I need to speak with you. And he said, what about? He said, oh, I need to speak with you now. He said, and so he stepped away. And she told him that, she said, that individual you've shown a picture up there, how would you like to meet him? And he said his jaw just kind of dropped. And he said, well, sure. She said, well, meet me on the White House or meet me on the Capitol steps tomorrow at 8 o'clock in the morning sharp, and I'll take you to him. So he said he showed up about an hour early, and he was pacing back and forth. She got in the car, or he got in her car, and she said, we're going to go to the Pentagon. That's where he works. And he said, but how am I going to get in? I don't have a badge. She said, well, can you take orders? And he said, yes, ma'am. She said, well, then you just follow what I do, and we'll be okay. So they got up there, and there was like two security gates. And as they got up to the first security gate, he tapped on her shoulder and said, now, I don't have a security badge. And she said, just shut up and do what I do. So she opens up her overcoat, and the security guard apparently sees her badge and waves her right on through. So he didn't know what to really do except the same thing. So he opens up his coat, and sure enough, he gets waved right on through. And then he sees that there's another security gate coming up. And as he taps on her shoulder, he said, look, maybe once, but I don't think twice. She said, just shut up and do what I do. So again, she opens up her coat. She gets waved through. He does the same thing. He gets waved right on through just like she did. And then they go inside the Pentagon, and she says, okay, you're going to go down this hallway, and you're going to see a room with a nameplate, nothing on it. She says, go in that room, and he'll be in there, and that's where you'll meet him. So Dr. Frank said he went in there. There were two people that were busy with some kind of administrative work, and he thought for sure they, you know, could hear him, but they wouldn't pay him any notice. So he said he shut the door again a little louder and cleared his throat, and sure enough, they kept ignoring him. And then finally he said somebody tapped on his shoulder and said, hi, Frank, how are you doing? Come into my office. And that's when he said he met the commander. And he sat down with him, and he said, well, where are you from? And he said, I'm from where your Bible calls the bright and morning star. And he says, oh, the planet Venus. He says, yes, but not the surface. We live on the interior of the planet. And he says, well, why are you here? And he says, I came here to offer mankind, I was assigned to go to four realms of influence, the academia world, the scientific world, the governmental world, and the religious world. And I'm trying to find followers. And he says, well, what about? He says, well, my civilization has the ability to change this planet by eliminating all sickness and disease, offering free energy, and also cleaning up all the pollution. And he says, well, that sounds wonderful. And he says, yes, but your president did not accept my offer. And he said, why not? He said, well, when I went into President Eisenhower's office and told him the offer that I was willing to make, Eisenhower said, are you crazy? Don't you know that if I were to accept your offer, it would totally collapse the financial structure of the United States? And he's probably correct because, you know, the whole system is based upon, you know, people getting sick and cleaning all the pollution. And it's just all a money-making business. And if you eliminate all that, then the whole thing just collapses. So Eisenhower did, he said, look, I can't accept your offer, but what we'd like to do is we'd like you to share some of your technology with us. Would you be willing to work with us for 3 years or work with us for a time period? And the commander said, well, I have to get permission from my people. I will leave and come back. If I have permission, I'll let you know. So he did leave, and then he came back. And the first time when he came, he was interrogated. They beat him up and tried to get information out of him. But they didn't get anywhere, and after he had his meeting with Eisenhower, he left and said he'd come back. And he did get permission. He said he would actually had permission to work for 3 years, and that's where they assigned him to the Pentagon. Of course, their intention was to try to pick his brain to gain technology for the military-industrial complex, but the commander wasn't going to allow that to happen. But he did work for 3 years. And what was funny was he's always going into work to, and he would see they were trying to find ways to destroy his spacesuit. It was a very thin spacesuit that weighed only 6 ounces including the boots that were connected to it, and you slipped into it, and it was made out of this indestructible material that was very lightweight. And they would try to saw it. They tried to burn it. They tried to pour acid on it. And he came in one day. He said they were trying to fire a high-powered rifle through it, and he just laughed because he knew it wasn't going to work. So, you know, they were just trying to pick his brain, but he never really divulged anything that would really help the military-industrial complex. But for three, in fact, they were never really intending to going to let him go. But he had the ability to, according to Dr. Frank, of raising his vibration to where he could just walk through the wall. So there was no way they could keep him there. And then Dr. Frank said, after he had his meeting with the commander, he was interrogated by the FBI for 5 hours. They kept wanting to know how he was able to get inside that Pentagon and get through those security gates. And he said, I just went through. They just let me through. And they just, you know, wouldn't buy a story. But they finally had to let him go. And Dr. Frank said before he left the commander said, I've already gone to those different realms of influence. The only one I hadn't approached yet was the religious realm. Would you be willing to work with me in this realm? And he said, yes, I would. And so he said, okay, I will see you in 1 year because my stint here is up. And 1 year I will get in touch with you. And Dr. Frank said he was driving his car in Burbank, California. And he said all of a sudden, out of nowhere, in the back seat of his car, he hears, hi, Frank, how are you doing? And he said he just about ran a red light. He pulled the car over and said, hey, get in the front seat like a normal person. And he said he was in touch with him ever since. And he'd been going on board their craft, which is called Victor 1, which is actually parked right near Lake Mead, but it's a higher vibration, so you can't see it. It's there every day, and unless they have a special mission they have to do, then it will temporarily leave the planet and come back, but it always parks right there. And Dr. Frank would go on board twice a year, and he would get these updates. So I heard this incredible story. I'd never heard anything like it before. It was just so original and novel. There's just no way that, you know, I knew that these were real experiences, according to Dr. Frank. They weren't just made up steel. But he said he had a newsletter, and he said you could subscribe to his newsletter if you want to keep up to date. So I kind of put that off a little bit, but I did finally subscribe to his newsletter, and I started relocating myself from I was living in the Woodlands, which is just north of Houston. It was so big at that time. It was 1997, and the keeping up with the short wave, it looked like everything was getting ready to come down as far as the, you know, they had the camps, they had everything already, you know, pretty much done to usher in their new world order, but and Houston was just not the place to be if that was going to come down. So I decided to relocate because I had a job offer up in Colorado, and I thought, well, the mountain sounds like a better place to be. So I relocated up to Colorado. And that's when I subscribed to Dr. Strange's newsletter. And I started reading his newsletter, and it was very interesting because some of the newsletter contained updates from Frank about, you know, his meetings on board and some of his personal experiences. But then there would also be meetings from some of the crew members. And there was the commander himself, which was Valiant Thor. And then there was his vice commanders, which was Vice Commander Teal, Vice Commander Don, and Vice Commander Thon. These were adopted brothers by the commander, and he brought them on the mission, and they kind of work under him. And then there's also the doc, and then there's the guy by the name of Unai. I never got to see any of these individuals, but I read about them, and we know that Unai is from one of the moons, I think it is, near Jupiter, and he has a single eye, so he's kind of like a cyclops. But Dr. Frank said he's about 7 feet tall, or maybe a little taller than that, closer to 8 feet maybe, but very, very friendly. And when he hugs you, he just, it's like a big bear hug, and he just picks you up off the ground. And he would go on board, and what they would do is they would discuss the hot spots on the planet and the good things that are happening on the planet, as well as keep track of the people that are detrimental to the planet and the people that are beneficial to the planet. And their technology is very advanced. They have these lasers that they could listen in on conversations like 1,200 miles away, They had, of course, advanced communication systems. They had on board, Dr. Strange said, they had on board this, like you'd see on Star Trek, where you go in there and you tell the computer, which speaks to you and knows and pretty well knows everything about you, what you would like for dinner or lunch or whatever, and you tell it. And he said he wanted his mother's famous spaghetti recipe, and he said it tasted just exactly like the way his mother made it. And you, what it is, you just you say it or you punch in a few buttons, and it's one of these replicators that just creates the food instantly. So he got to experience all these little things on the on board, and they were such novel, unique experiences. And, you know, when I was in Colorado, I had learned through the newsletter that he had these inner circle meetings. And I said, well, what are these? And it's just basically meetings in Las Vegas for those that want to learn more about what goes on board Victor 1. So I asked Dr. Frank, what is it, what's required in order to, you know, be part of this inner circle group? And he wrote me back and said, well, just write a letter to the commander telling him you want to be a member, because he's the one that makes the final decision, not me. So just state in your letter why you want to be a member of this group, and then he'll read it and get back, and I'll let you know what he says. So I wrote my letter, and basically I kind of sensed that they were wanting someone that was a giving, a loving person, someone that wanted to help the planet. You know, someone along those lines that had a good heart. And so I wrote my letter, and about a 3 weeks later, Dr. Frank said, yep, you've been accepted. So we're going to have our next meeting is going to be in November. And if you want to attend, you know, make arrangements. So I did. And when I went there, I was still kind of skeptical a little bit because, you know, wasn't really sure about everything, you know, because if this is, but I thought, well, if I'm going to find out for sure, I'm not going to just find out reading newsletters. I really need to go there and start talking to people and meet with people. So when I showed up, I was kind of wondering what it was going to be about. It was my first time going, but the people I met were some of the most loving people I've ever met in my life. And they were just, we basically sat at the Hotel Rio, and Dr. Frank would basically put together a booklet that would be made up of the various topics that he would be covering for that day, and the conference would usually last for two days over the weekend, and he would go through it'd be about 8 hours each day, and he would just go through all the various topics and what goes. Sometimes it would be about Venusian life. Sometimes he'd talk about personal experiences he had on board Victor 1. Sometimes it would be about things that are going on the planet. Sometimes it would be various prophetic events that are supposed to take place. So I, after attending the meetings, I decided to try to go as much as I could when I could afford it, because it was always kind of expensive to have to fly out there and pay for your hotel room and pay for the meeting and buy your food. So I couldn't go every time. But over the years, I think I ended up going to about 10 of them. And that's where I met I think it was in 2000. I started going in 97, and I think I met Rob Potter in 2005. So he found out much later, and I met him at one of the meetings. And we sat. They have a dinner on Friday night, and that's where I sat down with Rob. Met him for the first time, and Rob has kind of had his own. He's like a Pleiadian contactee when he was a kid. But after he had his experience, it kind of erased his memory. So he knows that he had an encounter with the Pleiadians, but he can't remember all the details. But he believes that those details will be coming to him in other words, they'll kind of bubble up, and he'll start to remember his experiences on board. I think that's happening right now for him, actually. So he's kind of wanting. He's wanting
Mr.
to kind
T.
of.
Yes. May I interject when you finish? Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, he was kind of connected with Cobra. Actually, I sent out one of Cobra's updates, and when I had met Rob for the first time, I said, hey, Rob, you know, I put out news every day. Why don't you get on my news list? And he said, well, okay, yeah, why not? So I started sending out news, and after about 5 years of him getting my news, and I started sending out these Cobra updates, he actually tried to meet with Cobra. So he did meet with Cobra. Became friends with him, and started actually putting together his conferences that he does. Now, I don't know a whole lot about Cobra myself. I just know that he's coming from too much, or where, you know, too much about his past or his history. But from what I can see, he does seem to be wanting to see the defeat of the cabal. So, I figured, as long as he seems to be working for the light, I'll continue to send out his updates. So
right.
Rob was getting those updates, and Rob decided to actually meet him. And but now Rob said that he's gotten in touch with the people that he had originally had contact with, and they're telling him to take a different direction, and he needs to focus now on his personal mission. So he's kind of breaking away from Cobra. Not that he has anything against Cobra per se, but he just feels like he's been kind of under him, and he needs to be doing his own thing. And so he's kind
Beautiful.
Of doing his own thing now. But he told
Beautiful.
Me, he said, Bill, Mr. T, he said, you've been sending out this news for so long, and it's such great news, but you don't have you need a wider audience. He said, why don't you just, I said, well, I'm not really working right now. I said, I'm having to take care of my mother who has Alzheimer's. I said, I don't really, have the money to really put together a website and pay all the expense. He said, why don't you just take a page on my website? I said, well, provided it doesn't, take me a lot of time to have to edit the website. He said, get with my webmaster, and what he'll do is we'll figure out some way to make it, easy for you. So we found out a way with his webmaster that when I email something out, I can also email it to the website, and it goes directly to the website. And so that really saved me a lot of time. So about 2 months ago, everything I send out, it now goes to the website. So.
Beautiful.
But I told Rob, I said, Rob, people, the problem I have is that we're pretty advanced on this thing here. We're pretty far along. I've gone through a lot of paradigm shifts myself. I dropped my Christianity because I knew that there was a lot of error there, especially when I knew that reincarnation was for real and it's all through the light worker messages and all that. I said, the problem is that everybody's at a different stage, at a different level. And I said, what they need is the big picture. They've got pieces of the picture. A lot of people are fully aware of the cabal, but I said they're not aware of the light workers, and they're not aware that this planet is ascending.
And they're not aware that we have other brothers and sisters in different dimensions.
Yeah.
Yes, so you're putting it all together in a big picture, and it's beautiful what you're doing. And I want to interject some points of all what you said as soon as you finish, and then we can talk about some other things. Go ahead.
So, there's a lot of people that are even aware of the ETs, but they think they're all dark, and it's all demonic. So, I said, well, what I need to do is find a way to get people to get the bigger picture. So how can I do that? And Rob said, Bill, why don't we divide this up? And I said, yeah, I want to divide it up too. Let's put it in different categories, because that way it'll be easier for people to find stuff. And stuff won't go away so quick. I said, if I have a single blog where I just post stuff on a single blog, stuff gets buried so fast that people will just miss stuff. So let's break it up into some categories. And I want to add one more, which hopefully I can do here in a couple of days, called full disclosure. Because I'm
full
getting
disclosure.
A lot.
Full disclosure. Good.
Yeah,
awesome.
Because there's a category that is kind of like dealing with whistleblowers, like the secret space program,
right.
All this secret stuff that is now coming forward. It's all part of disclosure. And I don't really have a category to put that in. Sometimes it kind of fits under USA. Sometimes it's international. But I thought, well, I really just need to have a separate dedicated category for all the stuff like ET disclosure, whistleblower stuff, secret space programs, all that sort of stuff, and it'll just go under full disclosure. So I'm going to try to get one more category, and any stuff that I had posted prior that's in another category, I'll move it over to that category. But right now I've got a pretty good health section, so if anybody's interested in the health and they want to keep up with what's going on with all that.
Mr. T, let's come back to that, and I want you to describe what's in your categories, but I want to cover what you said a lot, and I just want to sum it up.
Oh, yeah.
I'm like you. Beautiful thing you're doing. You're putting it all together and showing, the same story from different sources. That makes it real to somebody, more tangible.
One thing
first of all, I want to say I want to give kudos to Mim, as she's the one that brought you on, and you must have met her in Colorado. And
yes.
I want to thank you for sharing all that you have so far, your journey, full circle, because that journey is helping all of us, even those that are awakening, and we're all on different levels. The ones that are awakening took me tonight through my whole journey, a memorial of that, and what's going on, and it helps us to be have empathy for all of us that are on different levels. And I want
Elizabeth,
to just bring in some points that...
I want to say one thing real quick for your
sure.
audience here.
No, you're not done. You're not done. We're not.
Well,
you're not leaving. I just want to interject before we forget
I just wanted to say this,
that you brought. Sure.
I just wanted to say this this one thing. Rob said, Bill, why don't you put a little bio real quick on your on the website, just let people know who you know, a little bit about yourself. And I thought about that, and I kind of wanted to maintain my anonymity for just a little while until this until the announcements break. Anyway, I said, Rob, I got an idea. I said, I think it's going to help people a lot get the big picture. I said, instead of just giving a short bio, what I'd like to do is I'd like to give a more detailed autobiography of my life and provide a bunch of links so that people can walk through my autobiography and get the big picture. So that's what I did. I took some time off, took about 2 months off, and just concentrated on my autobiography, and I put a whole bunch of links in my autobiography, everything's going back to the early 90s all the way up to now. So as you work your way through that autobiography, you can just either read it real quick and just get a kind of a basic, you know, background of me. But if you want to take the time and really get educated, click on the links. There are some fantastic links in there. And there are some of the links will take you to articles. Sometimes they'll take you to audios. Sometimes they'll take you to videos. And it will help you get the big picture. By doing it this way, people can now go through the autobiography. If they already know something, they can skip over that. But if there's something that they're not, you know, that they're lacking, I guarantee you there's going to be a link there that they can go in and look at it deeper. They can examine it closer.
Absolutely.
And so that way what will happen is they can finally get the big picture. So that's what the
autobiography
is all about.
That's beautiful. And I want to go back to you talking to you come from the Christian realm. I come from the Christian realm. All of what you talked about tonight is just interweaving with how it happens on the Diamond Show anyway. We don't plan it, and everybody brings in different subjects, but they're not. They all weave together. And me and Tracy had a real long talk just last night, right, Tracy? We both come from the Christian realm, but in the Christian realm, we worked our way through, like, in the Christian realm, one leg and foot in the Christian realm box, one leg out.
Mm-hmm.
But there's, and going with Thor, the commander Thor, you know, Christian realm is breaking out. I'm telling you, there are many pastors, preachers, whatever you want to call them, evangelists, that me and Tracy know that know about ETs. They believe in them, but they just don't have the guts yet to talk about it. But
mm-hmm.
something happened in Arizona with Tracy just Sunday where there was breakthrough. A lady came in and told, hey, about ETs, and then people gathered around her, and so people feel free. So it is happening. We did pray in our conversation. Cynthia, me and Tracy prayed regarding the Christian realm and people not being afraid that know about ETs, the big Christians, and there's a lot of them that know. You just don't know yet. That the prayer of one over that, over the Christian religion realm. So we're going to see breakthrough. And then regarding, you know, the ETs, you talked about that awesome story with Dr. Frank and Thor, or whatever his name, and going to the government. Just a couple Diamonds calls ago, a good alliance came in, I think it was Tyler, so that they went, you know, to the government leaders for years and years. And now, you know, for disclosure and all that. Well, it ain't working. So they said they have gone to the people. They're going to have the people bring out disclosure. And
mm-hmm.
Diamonds is a part of it. You're a part of it. Many other groups are a part of it. So there's little fires starting everywhere around this earth. Imagine looking at the earth overview. Tons of little fires started already. Pretty soon we're going to have a big bomb fire.
And Elizabeth, that's what the commander was told when he went back to his civilization. He tried to go to the authorities, the governmental organizations of the planet, to get them to do disclosure. And when he reported back to his people and told them that they weren't interested, they said, okay, go back, but instead of working with the big authority people, work with the little people. start working with them. And that's why he got in touch with Dr. Strange's, and then Dr. Strange's put out the word for people that want to be part of his meetings, because the purpose was to not deal with government structures anymore or big authority figures, but to just deal with the people and just let it grow and grow and grow and grow to where it can't be denied.
Yes, thank you for confirming that. And that was back in 19 what that you just talked
That would have
about?
Been the commander actually had his meeting with Eisenhower. I think it was in 1959 or 1960. And
bringing it to the people.
Yeah, and then that came later. I think he left in 1961. Okay, so that's when he got in touch with Dr. Strangis, I think a year later. And started working with the people rather than the, and I think he's still parked there. Now, Dr. Strange has died in 2008, and he's no longer with us, and they don't have meetings anymore.
Yeah.
His wife tried to take over, but she just couldn't really pick up and couldn't really fill his shoes. So
1961, maybe that's why I came in 1963. We're going to bring it to the people. Who knows? I wanted to ask you a question really quick about Dr. Strange's.
Sure.
Give me a little bit of his background, just like a minute or so.
Okay.
Was he a normal everyday person that stumbled onto
something? His background is Italian. His father was a devout Christian. I don't know if he was a minister, but he definitely raised his children in that whole Christian paradigm. And Dr. Strange said he had an experience when he was a very young child where some angel came into his room and told him he had a divine mission for him. And it scared him, and he called his father, and his father rushed into the room and said, "What is it, son?" He said, "I saw a being who told me that I had a divine mission." And his father just prayed over him and knew that there was something special about his son. So I know that part about him. I know that even though Dr. Strange has had pretty much a mainstream Christianity viewpoint, he incorporated the fact that we're not alone in the universe and that God has many abodes and many mansions and with many of diverse people throughout his universe. And he adopted that into his Christianity. But the commander, was not here to necessarily change anybody's close-held beliefs. I mean, if they wanted to believe in a particular religion, he wasn't going to try to talk them out of that religion, but he was there to let them know that we're not alone in the universe and there are many beings, and he's here to help and assist. And Dr. Strange is definitely, believe that. So I learned, Dr. Strange, I would say, was a stepping stone for me. It got me to adopt the ETs into my Christian paradigm, but then I didn't stop there. I knew that there was more, and when I realized that, that the reincarnation is real, the Bible was altered in many ways, that there's just many untruths and things that were taught that didn't get actually translated correctly for what was really the message, the oneness message that Jesus was trying to teach. That's when I finally had to drop my Christianity, and I don't fault Dr. Strangis, even though he held on to his, but I saw him as a stepping stone. At least it got me to believe in ETs, the good ones anyway, which I needed to, because then from there I was able to then grab onto the lightworker messages and realize the whole truth about ascension and everything that followed.
Well, let me encourage you, you say drop Christianity. I come from the Christian and the Catholic realm. I'm not going to drop them. I'm going to still stay associated and just keep loving them into the kingdom, so to speak, like you are with your Mr. Truth Seeker stuff.
In fact, I have a really good way of approaching Christians, because I was, one of them.
We all go by our own heart's desire, however we do it. We're all unique. And I'll let you share in a minute, but we've got to... all you have to do is love them, and they'll come, just like you described in your journey of how you did it, And I just want to ask right now, is Cynthia, Lily, Daniel, have anything to ask Mr. Truth Speaker? We got Truth Seeker. We have like 10, 15 minutes, and then I have something to bring to you, Mr. T. And, so Daniel, Lily, Cynthia?
I'd like to just say, I love this guy. This guy's fantastic. Can I tell you, I'm just going to tell you a 15-second story about something I'm piggybacking on what he said about how a planet is formed in the beginning. Elizabeth, 4 years ago, I was telling my mother when I blew in town from California. You know, I always have those conversations with you, how the people look at me like I'm nuts. But I described how a planet is formed to my mother. And she looked at me like I was from outer space. And literally, what your guest host tonight was just reaffirming is, I'm laughing. I'm loving. I just can't wait to go for my 7 mile run tomorrow, Elizabeth. I love you. I'll talk to you in a little bit.
Thank you. Thank you. So we'll have to have you back, Mr. T, or do something offline or record it when we do it. When Chris is here and there's others, and we would have called in, and I'm going to talk to Chris about it, Dr. Strange's and Victor One Ship and Commander Thor and anybody there. I'm sure they're listening. I know they're listening now because while you were talking, Mr. T, I've been doing some automatic writing, thanks to Chris for motivating me, and he didn't suggest it. It's just what he does motivates. We motivate and empower each other, right? So that's what you do with Mr. Truth Seeker. So I asked if somebody on the ship would want to come through. And are you there? Did I cut off? Uh-oh.
You're still on. You're good. You're good.
Okay. Is Mr. Truth Seeker there?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Oh, there you are. Okay. So I called in and did the prayer one, and I asked who it was. It was Thor, the commander of that, what's the name of the ship?
Victor One
ship. Victor, oh, my God. I just thought of something. I seen a man who just got done running, Daniel. He was at a bus stop this month ago. It was chilly in Minnesota. Had no shirt on. White guy, curly hair, and just little skimpy shorts and tennis shoes. I walked by him. He had a great big round tattoo on him. That was something different, but I'm getting them all mixed up. I was at another place. A guy had a tattoo. I asked him what it was, and this was like a couple weeks ago. I believe it was an ET encounter, which was on a Diamond Show recorded. And his tattoo, I asked him what it meant, and it meant victory. But anyway, Thor came in. Yes, here I am. This is true, what Mr. T's story he's telling regarding Dr. Frank. And he says, keep up the good work. We are in the heat of major changes coming to Earth soon. Ha ha. He sent it in a fun, loving way. Mm-hmm. And yes, we are ones in the heat of bringing planning strategy to bring out the upgraded technology. This alone will take off oppression of the people. Be blessed, and we will talk more soon. And then I asked him, have you seen my diamonds? I put stuff in my diamonds. Anyway, you got to be on these shows to know. And he said, yes. And he says, and I said, pass them on to your people that you see.
That's a fantastic update.
And he says, yes, loves to you. Yeah, there you go.
That's great.
Okay. Yeah, and well, I just want to remind everybody of your site where you post. It was beautiful what you weaved together.
And want me to give out the URL for people?
ThePromiseRevealed.com. Right?
Yes, and then / Mr. Truth Seeker. Or you can just go to ThePromiseRevealed.com and click on the menu that says News. And it'll say, you know, it'll say News, Mr. Truth Seeker. It's not my website, but Rob gave me a web page so I could post stuff temporarily until I'll probably get a website of my own, but it's probably going to be project, you know. I'm hoping that when this prosperity is released, you'll see that in my bio that I was in one of these prosperity programs,
yeah.
So I'm still waiting on that. But
now
that
I want to ask you, Mr. Truth Seeker,
yes.
Just this week you post all of that, the whole picture you post. What's the most astounding good positive news or most astounding good positive pattern seeing in the last week or two through all the news you post?
Okay. Probably the biggest updates I'd say right now are, okay, we have there's two individuals that are like they're like twin flames, but they're like Elohim that have incarnated, okay? So, you know, you can have angels incarnate and Elohim as well as incarnate. And so these are very high spiritual beings, but they're, you know, in human bodies. And they are pretty much setting the pace of the ascension of the planet. They're pretty much opening the portals, and they're kind of doing, I mean, they're kind of doing things without even, they're achieving things without always knowing what they are that they are achieving, but they find out later. This is George Stankoff and his twin flame, Carla Thompson. And he is now, he was in Bavaria, Germany, I think, at the time when he started posting his stuff, creating his website to keep people updated. He created the universal, or what's called the, he put together a document that describes all the universal, that unifies all the sciences and everything together under the universal laws, okay? And so after he got that, he couldn't get anybody, of course, to accept it. As the new paradigm, but he did meet up with Carla, his twin flame, and now they work together. So the latest updates between those two is what I like to keep up with. And one is that they opened up a new portal that will allow for all of Lemuria, the ones that did not make it through the, you know, that did not go to the inner Earth. There was a whole group that died during the destruction of Lemuria, and this they were able to create a portal that is now going to guarantee the ascension of all past Lemurians. Okay, so this portal was opened up near near Vancouver, British Columbia. That's where they're located right now, but they're going to be relocating someplace else here real soon. And then they just had another update that shifted things to another higher level and guarantees more people will be able to make the ascension. So they're getting updates all the time, but they're kind of being ignored by a lot of the other light workers. I think they're posting some very important information, and I don't ignore them like some sites do. I think they're on the cutting edge of what's really going on with the ascension thing. So you'll see some things in the urgent update box that deals with some of their recent updates. So
we know where to go get the whole picture in just one click, not a lot. So that's great.
Well, I was just hoping to be able to help in some way. And so anyway, if it helps people, you know, with their own personal ascension was my goal, is to try to get people on board and drop the all the false junk and just accept what we know now is where we're headed, and that's the ascension of planet Earth.
You know, Mr. T, I honor and respect you for all what you've done. I know what the building is regarding, you know, with Mr. Truth Seeker, and then getting to Rob Potter and doing your whole journey. That's kind of like what my journey's been with, you know, the diamonds and getting people, mm-hmm. you know, like on Facebook, our friend, 3 or 4 or 5 people, they used to cut me off, can't have no friends, but something, well, we know what happened, we know the prayer we prayed, but something happened like a month ago, I must have got so many friends that they don't do that anymore, so just to get the word out. And I want to ask a really quick question regarding the ship Victory 1. Where did you say that landed? What, in California?
Victor 1. Victor 1 is parked right near Lake Mead, which is, you know, in Henderson, Nevada. And
Lake Mead, Henderson, Nevada.
Yeah, which is right near Las Vegas.
Do you know the specifics? Where in Lake Mead, on Lake Mead? Did they say
It's on the shoreline.
Shoreline, east, west, north?
Don't know exactly. I think it's in the book, though. If you get the book called Stranger from the Pentagon.
We don't need the book anymore. We're going to talk to the ETs about it. We're going to find out more information.
Well, good. They'll
tell you. I want to talk to Chris and others.
Now, one thing
we'll
kind of funny,
bring
though,
them in next week.
One thing kind of funny Dr. Strange just said is that now the ship can materialize. You know, it lowers its vibration, and it does lower its vibration. Part of the ship lowers its vibrations to allow for the car to go in and out, because they have a car that runs on water, and Vice Commander Teal helps the commander with the he's got his own project that he wanted to start to help save the children that are left for dead around the world. So what he does is he goes around the world and finds these people that are left for dead, and he takes these children in, and cleans them up and then finds them good families to be adopted. So they need funds to help buy the kids toys and things like that. So they, Dr. Strange has told everybody that the commander has a children's fund, donate to the children's fund. So they have to have a bank account. They keep all this money in. So they keep, the bank account is in Las Vegas. So Vice Commander Teal sometimes will, if she needs to get, you know, money for to buy toys for the kids, she'll go and drive the car into Las Vegas, go into the bank, and of course they can't tell her any different than anybody else.
Mm-hmm.
And so, but one thing
Vice
was kind of
Commander
funny.
Vice Commander Teal, right? Vice Commander Teal.
Now she was driving back one day, and Dr. Strange just said she likes to drive with a lot of speed. And she was really, you know, and out in the desert there, there's nothing really there to do but just drive fast. So she was driving fast, and a police officer turned on his siren and pulled her over. And so they have the ability to do what's called teleprojection, where they can actually make you think you're seeing something when you're not, or do something that you wouldn't normally do. That's how they were able to. That's how he was able to get through the Pentagon.
And let's not make them too distant from us, because we are supernatural
yeah,
beings.
Exactly.
That's our self, and they're helping
sure.
us, and we're helping them. Glory.
We'll be able to have those same abilities. So anyway, that's how he got through the Pentagon, is the teleprojection.
We do
the
have
commander.
The same ability. Let me correct you. Daniel's corrected me. We do have it. It's just in there, and the wells are being untapped as we go through
this.
Yeah,
it just has to be developed. And so the commander just allowed the security guards to think they were seeing a badge when he opened up his coat. That's how he got through. But anyway, the Vice Commander Teal was the police officer told her that she was speeding. He was going to have to give her a ticket, and he wanted to see her license. So she, you know, made it look like she used that teleprojection. So he thought he was seeing a license. And what was funny was that when he made out the ticket, she used this teleprojection to so that when he made the ticket out, he made it out to himself with his address and his phone number, and then gave Commander Teal a copy. And Dr. Strange said that he knows that when that police officer had to go back to the precinct, he was going to have some explaining to do.
The glory zone. Yeah. And I want to just make a point. Cynthia made it right from the get-go regarding how ETs have been negotiating, and we've been co-creating, you know, with the governments and your stories tonight, more than we think. And now, you know, Victor 1 ship with Thor and Vice Commander Teal. You know, that ship is in Lake Mead. I know Ray that's met 32 ET species, and they bring their ship every month, every other month, every 3 months on land. Oh, mm-hmm. There's more out there, too, you know. So it's going on.
And the commander's primary purpose, from what I understand, he had several, but one of them was to monitor all the nuclear facilities. And mm-hmm. they have the ability to deactivate the radioisotopes and the nuclear warheads so that if a nuclear missile is fired, they can deactivate it instantly. And that was the purpose, to determine which ones would get through, which ones would not. But we're at such a high vibration now, I think they all get deactivated now.
Okay, and then really quick, you said Thor was helping with government, religion. What were the other two?
Okay, the four spheres of influence that he was civilization told him to approach was the scientific community, which rejected him, the academic community, they rejected him, and the governmental community, they rejected him, and the only one that was left was the religious community, which Dr. Strange just represented, so he...
Okay.
picked up and ran with that one.
You know, we're going to take all this information, Mr. T, and I'm sure you'll be involved in it more. I don't know, but I know. I just have a knower that I don't know the details. We're going to take all this, and we're going to relationship with these guys, and we're going to work together to get this job done in these four rounds. They may have rejected them one time, two times, but three? Nah. That was a bases loaded.
Bases loaded.
Home run. Grand slam.
I want to put out there also when prosperity comes through, I've got some projects I'm going to start, and I'm going to need some people to help me out. So if anybody wants to help me with some projects that I'll be disclosing here real soon, go to the website, and there's a contact page. Just let me know, and I'll get back in touch with you.
How about a hint of some of the projects, like on what kind of realm, what kind of projects?
Well, I've got an idea that I want to start some conferences, and I want to bring together all the light workers under one organization. So if anybody wants to assist me with that, it's going to be quite a project.
Okay,
and,
cool.
Yeah, get in touch
with
me. I
like ideas.
And we'll work together, and I've got a few others too. So anyway.
Okay, what would you, in two or three sentences or whatever, how much, what would you like to say from your heart, from your whole journey that you described to us that was wonderful? And that you learned or that you've been inspired and empowered, what would you like to share with humanity, the whole world today?
I would say just continue to be as loving as you can, raise your vibration as much as you can, be of assistance to anyone. You know, I've put together what I have here. See if I can get it for you. I'll read them to you because I think they're important. I put together a list of what I call steps to self-mastery, and I'll read this. I borrowed 7 of them from Ashtar, okay?
Okay. And by the way, we talked to Ashtar. He came in with Merlin on the Rainbow Diamonds Council number 3. Yep, go check that out.
Oh, fantastic. Okay, I'll read these steps. There's actually 7 I borrowed from Ashtar, but because Ashtar was outside of duality, I figured, we have it tougher here in duality because we got to deal with the dark and stuff. So I feel like I needed to add a few more. So there's 12 steps. Okay. So step number 1, love everyone unconditionally, especially yourself. Step number 2, never criticize yourself or anyone else. Step number 3, bless every situation in your life, regardless of whether you view it as good or bad. Step number 4, open your heart daily and make a conscious choice to keep your heart open, come what may. Number 5, maintain a daily dialogue with your I Am presence, God Self, and ask for what you need in accordance with your highest good. Number 6, if you hurt someone in any way, be quick to apologize. That's one I added. Number 7, if you have been hurt by someone else, be quick to forgive them unconditionally to set yourself free. Ask for God's help if necessary. That's one I added. Become a truth seeker and keep an open mind to all new material presented to you. Put it on your mental shelf if need be and ask and wait for confirmation. That's one I added. 9, be gracious and show gratitude to anything that comes into your possession. Number 10, go out of your way to do good things for other people. 11, do only that which makes you feel joyous and alive. Number 12, believe in yourself, keep the faith, and never give up. That's it.
Oh, beautiful, beautiful. And let me, if you will, let me add step number 13. 13,
okay.
Is consciousness, our supernatural, natural self, which I just put together this week for myself, my heart. Seize the day. Live in the moment.
There you go. That's
you know, and but add that. Add peace in every moment as you seize the day. Practice adding peace and relaxation in every moment as you seize the day. Because that's the secret. That's
fantastic.
The secret. Have ears to hear, eyes to see. I'm talking to everybody. Because guess what? That's what the masters do. And you are a master. You may not know it, but you are a master. And look at the Buddha. Check on the Buddha. He sits. He rests. Relax. Peace. Okay, that's my 13. Is that okay to add, Mr. T?
No, sure. That's a fantastic one. Live in the moment. That's what it's about.
And have
in the
peace.
Now.
Peace is the key. If you can have the peace through everything, your vibrations, your tuning fork will be a great big one, and we'll just put it that way. If you can have peace, that's when glory happens. That's when supernatural, natural happens in you, through you, to the world, and beyond.
Yep, and that's what it's about, is getting your vibration up there for ascension.
Yes. Thank you so much for sharing tonight. It's been astounding. And hope to have you back. Give me a call, or I'll call you if you ever want to share anything.
Fine.
And
well, I'm
next
sure we're
going
to be having some. I think we're right on the verge, right on just the very verge of some major events happening. So So, you know.
Oh, that's what I'm going to tell you. You didn't hear my reading that Alik came in. Alik is a being who, we'll just say, Galactic Limousine Service. I talked about it earlier. And he travels the CEOs, like the government, and all who's in the Good Guy Alliance, ETs and humans on Earth and to different realms. But he said, his words were, it's a foot. It's a foot, you know, the verge. And we also talked about also a couple weeks ago, Tyler from a Good Guy Alliance, the ETs, came in and he commented something about, you know, it's close and blah, 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 and something about the Catholic Church when it falls. Well, there's a word out there that the Pope is supposed to make an announcement and announce that there are EETs, and it was supposed to be on June 5th. Now I heard it was June 15th. But whatever happens, we prayed the law of one for the Pope and all that want to disclose, even though may have a little fear and all that, so for the highest good of all concerned to happen. So what I'm saying, just know, if the Pope announces that some way, maybe even subtly or lightly, the Pope is known all around the world. He's a world figure. So if that goes out, and, you know, that could make the Catholic Church fall, crumble, or just put up an upheaval. It'll drive people to study, do the research, come to Mr. True Seeker, come to the Diamonds Call. But that's a major blow to the Matrix.
Oh, definitely. I mean, we know the heart of the conspiracy, you know, goes back to the Vatican. So it's definitely, that's going to have to be exposed. So it will at some point.
What Daniel brought in, what that goes to sign and wonder, was the Pharaoh. That was the last thing that happened before Pharaoh finally lay down his pride, put down his ego, and let the people, God's people, go. Is when his son
There's
died.
There's an article today that was posted. I'll get it up on my webpage here. It's from Mike Snyder, which is titled "The Central Banks Are Losing Control of the Financial Markets," and it's showing that the whole thing is on the verge of collapse. And I think the cabal is probably in meetings right now. In fact, Fulford's short blurb that he's got out there looks like that he's that's what reason he's late today is he's trying to cover what's going on in those meetings. So I suspect that the cabal, I don't think the light forces are going to allow a total financial collapse because it would bring too much chaos and fear and lower the vibration. But I think they've got the cabal pretty much to where they're going to be forced into the new system, whether they like it or not. And it looks like to me, according to some of my sources, that there was negotiations that took place several years ago where the cabal agreed to do the dinar reevaluation, but they go to these meetings and they agree to things just in order to end the meeting so they can get out of there and go on with their business.
Their games. So we're at the Pharaoh. We're at the last thing where the Pharaoh's son dies. He gives up his pride. He gives up his ego. And I want to say, too, the other sign and wonder, because we are fractals. We are microcosm of the macrocosm, meaning we're a little part that shows what's going on in the whole world. So that seven-mile run every day, well, that says Jubilee. And years ago, three, 4 years ago, I was walking in the park, literally an audible voice, I was thinking of that number, seven, an audible voice, a very intimate moment, whispered in my ear, said, you know, I was thinking of seven, you are my Jubilee. You are my completion.
Mm-hmm.
And we're doing that. That's for everybody. Yeah,
well,
so
I believe when the RV revalues, that's the first domino. And when that domino drops, you're going to see a whole series of things happen right behind it. Okay?
Yeah. So that's the key. That reevaluation is the key, is the sign and the wonder to unlock us that are getting ready to run the race. Run the race, right? Because we need that tool. So
I believe what the cabal did is they entered into a meeting. They agreed to allow for the reevaluation of the dinar without ever having any intentions of letting it happen, because that's how they operate.
Right, right. That's just absolutely.
They go in and then they agree to something, but then they always renege. They renege every single time. So
I think the Pharaoh, the pride and the ego. It's all good. It's done. We already glory.
But see, I think since the light forces got them to agree to this, they're going to hold him to it. You see, so
yeah, absolutely.
So what's
going to
happen? What's going to happen is it will revalue. It's going to be forced to happen, and we're at that point where they've tried to stall as much as they possibly can. I don't think they're going to be able to stall much longer.
End of the rope.
Yeah.
End of the rope.
You're into the rope now. To where once that RV happens, then you're going to see a whole series of events come right behind it.
Absolutely, and it's just a snowball. Snowballing in summer. Yee-hoo!
That's why they've been able to hold off, I think, all the other events, is they've been able to delay the RV, which they knew in the agreements they wouldn't have to be accountable for any of the other stuff happening, because the life forces said, we'll start with the RV. Once that happens, then we get to do this, we get to do this, we get to do that. And they said, okay, thinking that we'll just never let it happen. We'll just never let the RV happen, so none of this other stuff will happen. But see, now it's getting to the point where they can't stop it.
Absolutely. The snowball can't be held back. It's too big, too fluffy, too white. Thank you, Mr. Truth Seeker. It's been a pleasure. Okay,
well, thank you for having me on. And I'll be happy to come back whenever you want me. So.
Absolutely. We'll stay in touch, okay?
Okay.
Thank you, dear.
All right. Goodbye.
Bye. Okay, Cynthia, I wanted you to come in, and if you have anything else, and then I know Tracy and Annie and then Angel Sydney, if you're on, we'll go for that. So, Cynthia. Wants to come on in, listening, and you come say
I'm
hi.
I'm here.
Too. Oh, I knew somebody was there. Tracy.
Tracy, yeah.
Was that not phenomenal? Was that not encouraging, empowerment, Mr. T, talking about the Christian realm and our talk and our loved one prayer we prayed last night, glory and Thor and the victory ship.
Very awesome.
Yay! High five, girl. Now, Tracy's my good friend. She's since moved away. We used to travel in the Christian realm and get drunk in the glory, and it's so good, so good. And it's really, 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 really good. I'm telling you. That's our natural state. And I be darned, I'm going to get it out there. Right, Trace?
Yeah. I just wanted to say really quick, I think it's really awesome that Mr. T just shared that he didn't feel that the light workers people were going to allow like the economic collapse. That is definitely something I have been seeing as well. So
okay, say it again.
I don't see a full economic collapse happening either, and I've been pretty sure of that for a little while now. So
but right behind it, they got the alliance got the plan to. You know, not bring fear to the world, but to bring up the real for sake of other words, the Kennedy money, I'll just put it that way, and all around the world, not just USA. Yes, glory. Thank you for bringing that in. Now, I brought Tracy because she does these cards. She has lots of cards, and we did a couple last night. So we're going to do a couple from different decks, and they're pretty short for the whole room, for you guys to be encouraged. So I really like the fairy cards. And what other deck would you think we can do?
Well, I actually didn't bring the fairy ones tonight.
Ah!
I have the options of the angel cards. I have past life cards. I have healing with angels, and I have ascension card.
Okay, let's do an angel card and an ascension card. How's that?
Okay. Do you want the angel card?
Okay. So let's see. Hey, Daniel, what do you want to do the first, the angel card or ascension?
Let's play with the religious realm for a little while before we go to ascension. So let's play with the angels.
Okay, pick a number of a card. She'll pick a card. Just pick a number.
Number three.
Number three, Tracy, and the angels. And this is for all you guys. And all that will listen for the recording, and all UETs, and all around the dimensions. Yeah. Go for it, girl.
Okay. This one actually is saying Nine of Earth, which is showing a fairy that has a green.
Okay. Trace, do you have it on speaker? Sorry. Do you have it on speakerphone?
Yeah, just a second.
Okay, sorry.
Okay, can you hear me?
So say what it is. Again, it was kind of blurry, and then describe the card really good, and then do your reading. Yes, go for it.
It's Nine of Earth, and it's got a fairy with green around her, green all around. It's a nature scene. And she's got a green dress with green wings. And it says, enjoying life's little luxuries, spending quiet time alone, successful self-employment. So this is a good card. And it really does speak to, I feel, all of us right now, you know, because we're definitely experiencing that, enjoying the small things in life right now. At least I can say that for myself, and I feel that other friends, other light workers are experiencing that. And I will pull up the description really quick, and then whatever anyone wants to add about it. Nine of Earth. This is, this one says, your self-reliance, wisdom, and restraint have paid off. You've done excellent work and prepared for this time in your life. This has provided you with the opportunity to take it easy and enjoy some luxuries. You value your own company. You find peace and contentment in your quiet time alone. You're pursuing deeper meaning in life, so you retreat inward for inspiration. Additional meanings for this card, successful self-employment, unexpected financial windfalls, the appreciation of nature and animals, home improvement and redecorating. So it's
oh, that's
whatever
nice.
That says to however
hey.
That speaks to you, if at all.
Green's my favorite color. I like that. Yay. And, yeah, it speaks to everybody. Okay, thank you for that. And I'm going to open up the other side of the room. Somebody come in and give us a number for the Ascension card.
Six.
Okay, I heard somebody. Star six, bring in the number. Star six, and bring in the number.
Nine.
Thank you.
I said six.
Huh?
I said six.
Oh, you said six or nine?
Nine.
The nine's good too.
Okay, somebody said six, somebody said nine. Let's pick six. Number six, let's pick number nine. How's that? There we go.
Thanks.
And I heard, yeah, okay, we'll do both. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, number six is the Mahatma energy. In the golden era of Atlantis, many great souls placed some of their energy, as well as the Christ Buddha light and that of the 12 rays, into a sacred pool to create a high-frequency group consciousness. People could draw from this sacred pool to enhance themselves and their projects. This golden white Mahatma energy is once more available, and you are invited to draw it through your chakra system into the earth. This will raise your frequency and help the planet. You will leave golden white footsteps wherever you go. Send it to others to accelerate their ascension. And it says an affirmation, which says, I invoke the Mahatma energy to flow through me. That's number six, and you said you wanted the number nine?
Yes. No? Somebody, okay. Yes, somebody said nine, too.
Seven. Okay. Nine is Neptune. Is the planet of higher spirituality, and the wisdom of Atlantis and Lemuria is held within its ascended aspect. You are blessed, for you only receive this card when you are ready to receive their information. Your guidance is to tune into your Earth Star Chakra, then connect with Neptune, the cosmic Earth Star Chakra. Archangel Sandalphon oversees this center. He nurtures your divine potential and will help you download the spiritual light you are waiting for. This will expand your consciousness and greatly assist your ascension journey. I attune to the wisdom of Atlantis and Lemuria held in Neptune. That's the affirmation. The affirmation is I attune to the wisdom of Atlantis and Lemuria held in Neptune. Was there another one you wanted, or...?
I attune to the wisdom of Atlantis and Lemuria, and what was the other word?
Held in Neptune, the planet.
Held in Neptune. Okay, guys, I hope you took all of this personal because it was for you, 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 and you, and you, and you, and you, and all of us, okay? Take it to heart. Wow. Tracy.
Number five.
Yeah. Pull number five. And
Tracy's got a sexy voice, so I want to listen to Tracy talk. So shut up, Elizabeth.
Oh, my.
That's because you called me bad news the other day.
He's gutsy. He's gutsy, isn't he? Oh, you got to break up the fight, Tracy.
Okay.
Number five is the sun. The sun is the navel chakra of this universe. It radiates the divine masculine principles onto us. Choosing this card suggests that the universe is calling you to develop your qualities of decisive action, protecting the vulnerable, rational thinking, courage, and strength. Invoke the sun in order to light up your aura and fill you with renewed enthusiasm for life. This energy will enable you to help everyone feel welcome and empowered, which is an important ascension quality. Your guidance is to fill your aura with brilliant golden light, be true to yourself, and act decisively today. The affirmation is, I radiate golden light and take decisive action today.
Thank you.
That was beautiful, Tracy. Did you enjoy this little spot? Thank you so much.
Yeah, it's been fun to do this, yeah.
Yeah. Anything else you would like to share regarding anything, your journey, anything? What's on your heart? If not,
I will say earlier tonight I did pull a card for the whole group, and I got the Intergalactic Council. So I
oh my God!
Cool.
Really?
Yes. So I
oh, can you read
cool.
it? Can you read it?
Yeah. Yeah, I can pull that one.
And describe the picture.
Well, these don't have pictures on them. These are a little different.
Okay.
And I'll just pull that one up. Let me find it here really quick.
The Intergalactic Council.
Yeah, I did think that was pretty interesting. I was pulling that while. Everyone was giving what they had to give to tonight. So
and now, just so you guys know, Tracy hasn't listened to very many recent calls in the last 2, 3, or 4 months, so she don't know what's going on Diamonds, and she picked this call. I mean, this card. Yeah.
Okay. Oh, and by the way, I did get I pulled another card for tonight, and it was the Air card. The element air, which I thought was pretty interesting considering we were talking, Cynthia was mentioning elements earlier. So.
Absolutely. And by the way, Tracy and her husband, Michael, have been on the Diamonds call. Michael is in the, he's a lawyer. And everybody talks bad about lawyers, but I'll tell you what, he's a lawyer in there doing good work for the good of all humanity. All the calls I hear talking about lawyers. Remember, every single person is a human being. Just because they're quote unquote in the matrix or in the bad boy things, that doesn't mean they're bad. Anyway, go ahead.
Okay, now the Intergalactic Council of 12 great masters makes decisions for the highest good of this universe. The council includes Marco, Hilarion, Jesus, Ashtar, Kasumi, Almora, Paul the Venetian, Saint Germain, Kuan Yin, Lady Nada, Cerebus Bay, and Lord Maitreya. Saying or thinking their names raises your frequency. Recognize you are a multidimensional being. Connect with your deepest wisdom and focus on the well-being of the universe. Your guidance is to ask Universal Angel. Now, this one I haven't heard before, but I'm just going to try to pronounce it. And it's Bet-Yalel to take you to the Intergalactic Council in mediation or sleep and offer to serve the universe. This will greatly expand your consciousness. And the affirmation is,
I visit the Intergalactic Council today. But I just really thought that was neat because I kind of felt like that card was specifically speaking to us as what we were doing tonight.
We're going to visit this council. Can you spell that you couldn't pronounce? That's who to call upon, right?
Yeah.
The name. Can you spell that name?
Intergalactic Council.
The name
Intergalactic?
No, the name you just read, a sentence or two, the last sentence or two. A name,
the angel? To ask universal angel, and it's spelled B-U-T-Y-A-L-I-L.
B as in boy, U-T-Y-A-L?
I-L, yeah.
I-A-I-L. Ask that angel to bring you to that intergalactic council. Okay, well, we got a couple projects, you guys. Yoo-hoo! Okay.
Now, the air card is pretty interesting, too. The element of air supports truly magical cosmic silks or elements working for the elemental the unicorns. You are guided to ask the unicorns to direct Dom and his silks to spread the qualities of air, enlightenment, ascension, enthusiasm, freedom, and divine vision into the minds of those who need them. Also ask them to purify currents of air and blow them to polluted areas so that they may be cleansed. Help the fairies work with the flowers by acknowledging and appreciating them. And the affirmation for this card is, I invoke air to carry angels singing around the world and bring hope and peace.
Beautiful. Thank you for sharing, Tracy.
Absolutely. I just think that's really awesome considering right now you can really kind of feel there's definitely a lot of shifting and changing going on, especially, and I feel it today more than I felt it all week, and definitely feeling some peace of mind more than before, and just great things happening. I can definitely feel great things happening. So it's awesome.
Absolutely. Peace of mind. Be peace. Seize the day. Be in the moment. Peace in yourself. Yeah, that's great. That's awesome. Thank you. Stay tuned for the rest of the show. And we'll talk soon, huh, Therese?
Absolutely.
Yeah, it was great.
Can I ask you a question? This is Annie.
Yeah, and then Annie, I was going to have you come in and do your reading, and I want to see if anybody on the other side wants to bring in, you know, just say hi or make a comment thus far, and then we'll end with Annie. Okay, go ahead, Annie.
What is the card deck that you drew the Intergalactic Council from? I'm just curious.
That is from the Ascension cards.
They're just called the Ascension cards? Okay.
Yep.
By Diana Cooper.
Hi, Diana. How are you? Oh, by Diana. That's Tracy. Oh, my God. I'm like...
Is this Diana or Anna Cooper?
Diana.
Oh, Diana Cooper. Okay, great. I'll look those up. No, I have a lot of different cards I read also, but I haven't heard of those. So that's great. Thank you so much.
Absolutely.
Great. Absolutely great. Thank you. So is anybody in the Star 6, anybody wants to say anything at all? Come on in. Now's your turn. I think I have the room open.
Hi.
Patty, hi.
No, it's Allie.
Oh, Allie.
My name's Allie, yeah. I just want to let all of you know how positive I find these shows to be. I know Cynthia, we go way back, so she's the one that told me that she would be on your show, and I just thoroughly enjoy it, and I always look forward to hearing everything, and I find it to be inspirational and a very big energy boost, and we all need that. We so need to have groups like this where we can be together and just urge each other on, you know, in the light. And I just really wanted to let you know how much I appreciate everything that everyone's doing.
Oh, thanks, Allie. Share with us a little bit about yourself. What's your contribution, so to speak, that you're doing?
I'm an artist, and I used to paint with Cynthia, and I'm looking forward to starting oil paintings again, and that's my passion. I do colored pencil work and charcoal and that sort of thing, but I love oils, and Cynthia was the one who opened me up, and I'm really anxious. I have this burning desire, many images that I want to get out. And I love basically everybody. I don't judge. I do have a difficult time sometimes in the world because I just look around and there's so much going on, and it's like I want to fix it now, you know, and it's hard for me to be patient, very hard to be patient. But I've had some unusual experiences. I actually did die. And I was clinically dead 15 minutes, and I had this absolutely wonderful after-death experience and went to heaven. And I didn't want to come back. I was actually angry when I came back. And I felt at that time, it's been a number of years ago, maybe 5 years ago, something like that, that I had like one leg in heaven and one leg here. And it was really difficult for me to become grounded again. And I had another experience where I was saved. So I'm very blessed, and I'm very, very lucky. But I really want things. I'm just so excited to know that it won't be long, and this whole world is going to be such a wonderful place. And when I go to bed and I meditate and pray at night, I see, you know, the world is a beautiful, beautiful, green, lush place, and all the waters are just so crystal clear, and animals everywhere, and people sitting under gorgeous trees, and they're happy. You know, everybody's happy, and that's what I want. I want us to move forward. That's basically, I guess, it.
Wow, beautiful. You know, the word I thought of when you said a playground again.
Yes, exactly. Exactly,
yeah.
You know, where everyone is what we should be, not what has transpired throughout history. And it'd also be really great to hear about our real history, because I know there's so many things that we just haven't been told, and that'll be an exciting time, too.
Well,
very exciting.
Allie, right? Allie?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, let me share with you, because it goes with what you said. It's just like a paragraph long. My writing I did on June 7th, Sunday. I am Sada, the elect of a council. I am Sada, the elect of the council of Traden. In this universe, I come here today to deliver. Oh, somebody's talking. Can you start six? I think Heather. In this universe, I come here today to deliver a word for encouragement. The galaxy is buzzing with excitement with what's about to happen. The ignition of, quote-unquote, the party, all around Earth first and extending eons beyond, the party, is a kickoff for the golden age. Elizabeth, okay, so get ready. Many things will happen. Click, click, click. Prepare preparation for the party now. And Elizabeth, when's the party? And I said, when's the party? And and the trip in July is the pre-party. Anyway,
that's beautiful. Beautiful. I enjoyed speaking with you, and you've got a lot of you're just so positive, and your voice is so uplifting, and it's a joy to hear all of you. It really is.
Yes, all of us. Thank you for sharing.
And say hello, and I'll be on, you know, when your show is on. And thank you all very much for everything.
Betty.
Thank you. Oh, and there's somebody else talking. Hi.
Hi, Elizabeth.
Who is this?
This is Candy.
Candy, hi. How are you?
I'm great. My 8-year-old grandson was saying the Law of One with us tonight and was excited to hear about Commander Thor and the Cyclops, and that was really fun.
Oh, nice. You sounded like a little girl. I say, who is this? She's 7 years old. I was like, oh, it's Candy.
Yeah, I got a lot of years. I started long before 92. Of course, in 92, I was certainly listening to shortwave radio. In 82, I was marching in Europe and trying to fight the common market, and in 72 I was marching in front of the American embassy and things. But listen, I want to let your audience know that Chris is going to be on my conference show on June 24th, and I'd like to invite your audience to mark their calendars. That'll be 8:30 Central Time on Candy's show, June 24th.
June 24th. And remind me, Candy, a week ahead of time so I can blog that too, okay?
Okay.
And by the way, Candy's been around. I mean, she went through, you know, we're wheels within wheels, cycles upon cycles, and the cycle's been repeating. She was in the cycle she just talked about and more. So Candy will be sharing on not this Thursday, but next Thursday's Diamond Special show. She's got a lot to share, and she's reading right now the book, The Law of One, the raw channelings that David Wilcock read. We've talked about it on the last few Diamond shows, and she's going to do like a book report with us as far as she's got. So that would be great, because now we're full circle, because that's actually why I started the Diamond show. Candy, I thought we were going to read that Law of One. That's what my purpose was, but it's morphed into this. So there we go.
Yes, and the experiences I've had in the last year makes the Law of One book so much more vibrant to me. It would have been special if I could have read it when it was published in 84, but I really get it so much more now, and I'll be happy to share it with your audience.
And she's got even more to share, but we'll say that. Thank you, Candy. I love your name, Candy. Yummy.
Thank you, Elizabeth, and your friends.
Thank you for sharing. Anybody else? Star 6. I like it when you guys share, too, because we're all one, you know, and it's 10-10. I like that number, too. Okay, well, I'll leave the room open. Let's bring in my dear friend Annie, Midnight Think Tank Annie. Come on in, girly.
Hi.
How are you? Are you hanging in there?
No,
you're
I'm
laughing. Are you laughing at me or are you laughing with me?
I'm laughing with you.
You better be.
Well, it's interesting that you mentioned the think tank because right before the call started, I live in Massachusetts, but I was up in Plymouth visiting some family. And whenever I'm up there, I always go to the National Monument to the Forefathers, which is high, high up on a hill overlooking Plymouth, Massachusetts. And it's the first national monument that it was ever erected. And it's very moving because, you know, the world we live in now, if you're woken up about what's really going on, it's easy to, you know, get distressed about the way our government is and all. But we have to remind ourselves that there are great people working behind the scenes in government on all levels, and as well as our connection to the galactics, and to keep in mind that our forefathers really had wonderful godly intention. And you can actually Google the National Monument to the Forefathers so you can look at it. Visually, it's amazing. And it's about almost 80 feet tall. And the main figure is the figure of faith. And it's just to go up to this huge monument, which was carved by stone carvers and erected by the Pilgrim Society in 1889. And to look at this statue of faith, and on the monument, this is what it says. This is just a reminder to all of us as Americans when we get a little, you know, discouraged about what's going on in our country right now. This is what's on this beautiful monument. Erected by a grateful people in remembrance of their labors, sacrifices, and sufferings for the cause of civil and religious liberty. Erected by the Pilgrim Society in 1889. And at the time, the governor was William Bradford. And on the back of the monument is this quote from Governor William Bradford of Massachusetts. Remember, this is 1889. Thus, out of small beginnings, greater things have been produced by his hand that made all things of nothing and gives being to all things that are. And as one small candle may light a thousand, so the light here kindled hath shone unto many, yea, in some sort. Yeah, somebody, am I still on? Am I still on, Elizabeth?
You're still on, yes.
Okay, sorry. Okay.
Read the last sentence again.
Yeah. And as one small candle may light a thousand, so the light here kindled both shone unto many, have shone unto many, yea, in some sort to our whole nation. Let the glorious name of Jehovah have all the praise. Governor William Bradford. And I just find it really inspiring to remember, you know, our forefathers at a time like this.
We got somebody on the moderator line that's unmuted. I hear somebody talking.
Yeah.
Star 6, please. Go ahead. Sorry, Annie.
Okay. And around Faith, Faith is standing up with her hand in the air and holding what appears, you know, to be like the Book of Knowledge. And around her are four other statues and seated below her. And the one immediately below her is Liberty. Then there's Education, Law, and Morality. And on either side of Liberty are smaller statues. And on other side of Liberty, they engrave words. And on both sides of Liberty is holding the chains that have been broken. And on one side is you know, engraved peace. On the other side is tyranny. So Liberty has broken the chains of tyranny to bring us peace. On either side of the statue, which is Education, Liberty is a male statue. Education is a female statue. And on either side of her is Wisdom and Youth. Law is a male statue. And on either side is Mercy and Justice. And Morality is a female statue. On each side of her is Evangelist and Prophet. So I just wanted to talk about that a little bit to remind everybody that the intent and the founding of this country, you know, just like there are many fine people now who really want to bring back the moral intent of this country, that the intention very early on was a godly and divine one. Now, that brings me to reading, because Elizabeth and I had discussed, I have a book in my possession that was written around 1978. I found it in a little library swap place at one of the churches, at actually the Spiritualist Church in Onset. And the book must have been a hardcover book. The hardcover was ripped off of it. It was all tattered on the outside, but I knew I had to open up this book. And it was the book published in 1978 called A Spiritual Bouquet from the Ascended Lady Masters, and it's basically channeled messages from all the Ascended Lady Masters, because usually people talk about the male Ascended Masters, and they don't they actually aren't educated about the Lady Ascended Masters, and there's about 80 of them in this book. And chapter 57 is the Goddess of Liberty. So I was just going to read that. And that's why I gave you the introduction of the Forefathers Monument. And, you know, as I say, you can go on and look at it visually online. And there's also a documentary done about it. I'm trying to remember the documentary, what the name of it is. Not sure, but if you just Google the Forefathers Monument, Plymouth, Massachusetts documentary, it was actually, I think, a full feature documentary. You'll find that. It's very moving. So it has brought joy to my heart each time. Oh, this is from the author, the channeler. It has brought joy to my heart each time I look back to the year 1970 when I asked and given the privilege of going on a mission for the freedom flame of which the Goddess of Liberty is the guiding spirit. And this was Samuel Partridge. I was asked to visit the state capitals of the United States of America and decree light from the rotunda of each. And he actually went around the country and did this. As I went along, a cord of light unreeled off from my motor home, connecting each state capital with another, the United States Capitol and also the Statue of Liberty. This mission of light was performed to create a bond of etheric light throughout the country, joining it all together for the high purpose of unity, and as an avenue and carrier of more light to be spread over the country through these channels. Whenever the need presents itself, this light will dissolve and neutralize negativity and darkness wherever it may show itself. The original cord of light as created is still intact and is in use under direction of the freedom flame. But keep in mind, this was written, this book was published in 1978. This story of this trip is interestingly told in a book entitled He Walked Where I Walked, printed in red, white, blue, relating to the visit of each state as it occurred. This book is still available. Upon reading this volume, you too can help in the continuance of spreading the light. Joy comes to me now as I introduce to you the Goddess of Liberty, as she brings her chapter to the book as an Ascended Lady Master. So this is the Goddess of Liberty. I come today bearing the flaming torch of liberty. I am here from my focus of light in Marseille, France, where it burns in the etheric eternally. This torch of freedom is indeed a symbol. It is one of the greatest symbols that you could ever visualize. I am the Ascended Lady Master known as the Goddess of Liberty. I am an Ascended Lady Master because I once lived on another planet from which I made my ascension. My words today will enter into the pages of this book, which you are now channeling, because it represents so much not only to the United States of America, but it represents a beacon to the whole world. This statue, which was presented to the United States of America and placed on the shores of New York Bay, was given by your beloved countrymen from France, those who revered what had taken place and why it had taken place. Now it stands there in all of its beautiful statuary as a symbol of the flaming torch of freedom and liberty for all. Those who are from other lands come to the shores of America with dreams. They dream of freedom, freedom of religion, and freedom of speech, freedom of everything that a human being should have. And as they sail into the harbor and view this beautiful statue, it is no doubt the most thrilling experience anyone could ever have as they enter the country of the United States of America. I want to interject here, if you've ever climbed up into the Statue of Liberty and sat in her crown and meditated like I did one year, it's just an amazing experience. They hope to fulfill the dreams of their hearts. Many are refugees. Others come through their desire and efforts to reach the shores. where they feel they will live in a land of freedom, which is the meaning of this great statue entitled the Goddess of Liberty. I am the spirit of this, and as I tell you, I am an ascended Lady Nestor. Therefore, I speak today from the depths of my heart to all of you who live in the wonderful land of America. I also speak to all of you who live in the other countries, to those who are not happy or feel they are held down, restricted, even in bondage. And I say to all of you throughout the complete world, it is not the wish of the God Eternal for any of his children to be bound with chains, bound in any way. It is his will that you should each be a free spirit. I do not mean that you must not conform with the laws of each land. Indeed, you must, but be free. Feel free in your spirits. Feel free to live your lives as you choose it, providing it is within the law and providing you choose a good life. Upon the Statue of Liberty, there are inscribed many sentences meaningful, and I would ask that all of you review this writing which is contained upon the Statue of Liberty. Study it and remember that when this was presented and inscribed upon this statue, it was done in love for the future of the world and the peoples of the world. But unfortunately, at this time, I must report, and I know you are aware of this, that the meaning has been desecrated. The purpose of the open arms to everyone from every shore in the world, because unfortunately they have not always been the kind of people who could represent the country in its best interest. All you need to realize are the conditions of your world at this time, with the wars, the hatred, the politics, which are so confusing to most of the people, involving the greed for war, the greed for money and power. This was not the intent when the Statue of Liberty was placed upon the shores of America with arms wide open to receive the neighbors, the countrymen, the people of all lands as they came to the shores of America. Although today there are people dreaming of coming to America, the land of the free, so that they can live this life of freedom, they are dreaming of this and planning to arrive when they can, but I fear many would be disappointed now if they knew the real truth about certain ones who have filtered through into the land of America. The only way you as American citizens can overcome this sad fact is to live your lives as examples. Do not be drawn into this intrigue of war that is tearing apart the hearts of mothers whose sons are having to fight wars, useless wars. You must be examples. You must see that you are voting for the qualified leaders in the country. It is up to you, each as an individual, to do your part, to not allow this beautiful dream to be shattered. I, as the Goddess of Liberty, am working diligently and lovingly with all peoples, trying to instill into their minds the importance of living together in freedom, being liberated in their spirit to live a wonderful life. If you need my help, please call upon me. I ask you, as I have done before, to call for my help, and I will surely help you. I am particularly helping the leaders throughout the world because certainly they are in need of help. And if they do not call upon the divine power for help, they will not be successful. This is now the only hope of the world to turn to the God Almighty and ask for his help and to live the way he would have you go. Beloved ones, this is the only way, the only hope of the world of tomorrow. My message may seem a little stressful today, but it is important, and I was chosen to be here just for this purpose. I represent the women of the world as an ascended Lady Master be in this book, because this book shall be read in many lands. It will reach the shores of every land throughout the world. This is why I have spoken this way today. Although I will say just a few more words to the women, I know that you in your homes teach your children to live properly, to live in love and freedom, being the ones to guide them. You are to be the epitome of womanhood and motherhood, guiding the future world in this manner. I extend my blessings to all of you, mothers, for such a noble effort. First of all, to become mothers, to receive the spirits that have been given to you to raise. I will mention the fact that I can foresee more liberty, more freedom in every way among all peoples because they are beginning to know this is the only way, this is the answer to everything. I am placing a blessing upon all of the leaders in the United States of America at this time so that they can perform their duties divinely. I know that many of the leaders in high places are bending their knees to humble themselves before their God because they realize how important this is. The United States of America shall always be the land of liberty and freedom. One day the hope is that all countries, all people shall live in freedom, and it is coming to this point. This is the turning point now, and this is why it is happening. It must be this way. It has been divinely blueprinted, and it shall happen. It is up to each individual, every living human being upon planet Earth. I did not bring a flower with me today, although I knew it is the custom of the Lady Masters, but I shall instead leave with you the beautiful concept of freedom and liberty. And I know when you see the symbol attached to the spiritual bouquet, this motto, you will remember. You will know why I have placed it there. Good afternoon, with love, compassion, and understanding for all. I am the Ascended Lady Master known as the Goddess of Liberty. And even though that channeling is dated, I think there, you know, it's a lot of good in it. And even though we're going through such hard times in this country, just a reminder.
That was a beautiful reading. The Goddess of Liberty and Encouragement and Empowerment. Thank you for reading that.
Yeah.
And sharing that with us.
You're welcome.
Yes. Dear. So, huh?
You're welcome.
Oh, you called me Cynthia? I don't know. I'm hearing things. Thank you, Annie. And I'm going to put that on. I want to talk with Chris about her, too. I want to just tell everybody next week, what's next week? Next week's show, we have another guest. Oh, where's my book? And that will be Colonel and Willis. Willis is had lots of experience with ETs, aliens, and other stuff. And Colonel is a good friend that we met a long time ago when we were, me and Mim were co-hosting, moderating on Maxine's call. We ran into Colonel when we were having trouble on Drake's call that had thousands of people. Nobody could hear anybody. Everybody was unmuted. So me and Mim were being the clarion callers, and we got our voices heard to come to Maxine's call because she was taping it live. Somehow they could hear it better. And then that's how we met Colonel, funny. And Colonel came, we started talking to him, or otherwise known as Jim. Isn't that cool? Okay, so Colonel Willis and amongst, you know, Daniel, Lily, and Cynthia, and Chris will be back next week. And maybe me. Who knows, right? Anyway. Okay, let me end with this. Let me just see, anybody on the other side of the room want to say anything really quick? I'm going to end with a minute of music, and if you want to stay, if anybody wants to do an after party, I'm in for it for a little bit. Anybody on the other side of the room?
Don't commit me to next week. I might ascend before then. Just I might be here. I love you. I remember it's a race. It's a race. I want to become invisible before you, Elizabeth. I'm looking to that light. So I'm going to do 7 tomorrow, and I love you. I love you. I'll talk to you later.
Love you. Okay, let me make sure. I'm sure he wants to be up in there in the front. Okay, everybody, star 6, anybody wants to come in before we end the recording? I'll give you a few minutes. Hi. Oh, somebody said something and they cut off. Go ahead.
Two people said something. I was saying I'll still be here. But
okay.
I just wanted to say I'm horrible at names. The guy was talking about
Mr. T.
About education and stuff, that I thought about TEDx.
Who's that?
Because that's kind of like an educational, what, TEDx?
Mm-hmm.
It's an information place. Oh. It's got lots of information there.
Okay.
I don't know how else to explain it. It's a website that you can go to, and different people get up there, and they talk about different subjects. And there's
TEDx, TEDx.com?
Yes. Yep.
Okay.
TED Talk.
What?
TED Talks. They're all over the internet. Go to YouTube. You'll see TED Talks.
Huh. Well, enlighten us, you two, on what that is in case somebody doesn't know what it is, like me.
Just go to YouTube and put in TED Talks, and everything that this woman's talking about is going to show up. She's a lovely person. Listen to her.
He called you this woman. He knows
you,
Heather.
Thank you, Daniel.
Okay.
That's all right. You didn't know who I was at first either.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did.
Yeah. And sometimes people...
I don't know who I am.
Oh, my God. Ah!
Sometimes people, they host TED Talks in their local area, and then they're broadcast, and there's different times of year when they have the live TED Talks. But the other thing is, and a lot of it, there's a lot of science and inventions that are talked about and all that, but you also have to remember about TED Talks. They're wonderful, but also people like Bill Gates gives TED Talks. So,
he's under the law of one, the highest good of all, concerned with him praying, doing some stuff.
Right,
anyway.
But you just
which brings me to
TED Talks. You have to take with a
gunk.
Gunk.
Yeah. So we did the law of one over education. So I would try it again.
Oh, there you go. And was there somebody else?
Good.
Yeah, Heather and Annie, was there another person too that came in?
I think so.
Come on in, you guys. Or was that Annie and Heather that spoke, said hello? Okay. Everybody ready for a minute of music? And then we'll go to the after... The party, like a party. Okay, this is reference number 240 on the recorded line. It's available right after we get done recording. You guys know the recorded number, and it'll be up on YouTube day or two. Okay, let's do it. Shine, diamonds, shine. See you next week.